stuck, ending up where we start.
Work your fingers to the bone. I know you can keep me warm. Don't you leave, it's getting cold. I got you and you got me. Don't be scared if we gon' bleed. Love and war the same damn thing. Yeah. Oh love, it's like I'm fading away. I want more, I want more. Oh love, I really want you to stay. We'll push it to the edge for real. We'll push it to the end, to the end now. We'll push it to the end, to the end now.
Good afternoon, good morning, and good evening. My name is Anthony. You can call me Nitro if you so choose. And today is a very special day. Today, we are watching the culmination of an 11-week tournament. It's the spring seasonal 2023. It's time for the grand final. DC versus Greyhounds. Gonna be playing on Utah Beach. Before we get to the match, we have a great show planned for you today. We're giving out our caster awards. We're watching highlights from the seasonal. We're talking to the seasonal org in a wonderful fireside chat, and we're getting ready to see how this tournament all ends. So stay tuned, buckle up. We'll be back shortly, starting off with the caster awards right after this highlight reel. Thanks so much, and we'll see you soon.
Bullied. Absolutely bullied his way through.
Man.
And that tank is no longer moving. That tank is down. That's a great kill from this AT gun crew. That's going to be Miller, Low Life, Mr. President, and Cosmos in the area.
It does look like a precision strike from American.
Oh my god.
Oh, did he get two?
Holy shit. Yeah, fucking
one
done.
One of them was the Panzer IV.
Here comes the tank down now. Oh, he's driven straight into the tank. He's driven straight. Oh, no!
Kani Turbojürgen, der hat richtig hier Rocket Barrage hier.
Okay, that's a mid squad and a rocket into the river.
Oh, a big hit on the truck. First left.
Oh. I hit the truck.
What the? Medium, medium. Get Nazi.
Oh,
that way. Oh, what a dick. Sure. Okay. Sure. Let's get the cinematic cam for this. There we go. Congratulations, Phoenix.
Tacticum land one or two shells. One or two key shells is all they need.
Yes.
One.
Gets
him. That's one. Come on. Can he make the last one? Coming up, Tacticum. Does he nail that shell?
Oh.
Yes. He gets two.
Yeah, we are going to see him run up on a couple more players here. That's going to be Foxley right below him. Is he going to see him in the grass? He is going to spot him. Going to get another kill on Keflin as well.
Look at this rampage by Leroy. Lock him up.
He's going to keep going. Gonna charge through the smoke. Gonna get himself another kill on Private Rogers. Star's in there. He's gonna get Star as well.
Wow. Three OPs. This dude just single-handedly wiped PGM's attack.
And oh my god. Oh my. Oh, this is against the Geneva Convention, I think. Ring's still alive.
On the hard cap.
It just looks like the she
shot.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my god.
Everybody.
Holy shit. They just go fucking farm, man.
Влево уходит. Влево по пингу.
Надо зачистить.
Влево, сука, уходит. Пробуй.
Пробуй. Я нашел Гарик.
Успели. Задний. 76-й, не попал выбить. Блять, башню направо. 3 часа.
Я снял гарнизон.
Precision по мне. Блять, пизда. Нам.
Ой, красиво.
But he's trying to get.
It was nice one.
What's going on?
Let's have a look as they come in here. The MG's waiting. It's a direct. It's a bombing run on it, but I think it might be a bit too late. Garrison.
Huh? FLC?
It's gonna. It must spawn in 2 seconds. Oh. There we go. Oh.
What?
Oh.
No.
The swarm.
Guys, kill him.
Guys, what are you doing?
What the fuck?
No.
How
is he alive? What? No, dude.
What?
How's friendly shot? Are you blind?
No, that's
you're questionable.
Dude. Mit Flammenwerfer. Be quick.
Quicknix. No
oh,
way. Quicknix killed his own player.
Drive.
I think he doesn't even notice it. Yeah, but now the problem is the garrison is up there and the garrison is
getting hot.
And then there you can see Kajera's moving back and I think the tank just.
Yeah, he spotted him. Tower is turning.
What the fuck is going on here?
What?
Oh my god.
Oh.
No! That was so smart from the commander.
Oh, but
no, Entis fucked it up!
Oh, Entis!
You had one job?
Oh, come on, yes! Entis!
No. Entis, you had one job! Entis, oh no!
Do a little bit of murder in there.
Did you get the knife out?
Please, knife kill, let's go, Heidi! Nope, he's.
Knife, hello? Hello?
What? Heidi, turn him around!
Oh, look at that! It's a tank! I killed that one guy! And now... Stop!
Oh, my, get stopped.
Need to hop out now, boys. Ah. What the hell was that?
So...
He lived!
What?
What?
And... Can we get a Hoopa? And... Hoopa one?
No! You will not get this!
That's an enemy jeep. That's a camo.
Just try to crash into commander. It.
He's just knocking the tank around.
He's just fucking with the steward.
What is that?
Get under it. Yeah, that's what he's saying. Get under it. Go on.
That's right. Pin him. He's trying to machine gun him.
Oh, and the steward is now stuck.
Let's go, Kubelwagen.
It's stuck. That counts as a kill. Oh. That counts as a kill in my opinion.
He's still alive. Oh, is he gonna go for a knife? Hello? Hello?
What?
What?
What just happened?
What? What the fuck did we just see?
Little channel a chant. Channel a chant for dugout. Dugout.
Nestle or natural.
Oh no, I had a crash. Is everybody okay?
Just get re-punching, dude. We're gonna have a massive fucking punch being shit here.
Clip on the TV, steezy. Never, never want preemie. We're not giving them a freebie. We're not cheap, we're not easy. See me on a 2-2 clip on the TV, steezy. Never, never want preemie. We're not giving them a freebie. Yo, I stepped in looking like Carly. Energy bar me. Energy bar me. I stepped in looking like Carly. Energy bar me. Energy bar me. Energy bar me. Run a punch and give a halfway. Stood there.
And we are back. Welcome, everybody. Thanks so much for hanging around. We're going to keep the show moving. And the next part of our show is it's one that's very special and important to me. You know, I've been fortunate enough to be casting seasonal for what I believe is my third seasonal that I'm casting games for. And I've come to learn in, you know, these three editions that I've gotten to help and stream games of, that there is a lot of work that goes into doing something like this. That's not just me speaking about, oh, I put in so much work into this. The point I'm trying to make is there are a lot of people on our casting team. In fact, everyone on our casting team has really shown that they can meet the level of quality that I think seasonal deserves. Whether it be, you know, waking up at 2 or 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning to cast games, bringing on guests, making content before the games, doing interviews after the match. We've seen some amazing graphics that people come up with, and just some really unique and creative ideas that our casting team has come up with. And so now that I am, number one, streaming my third edition of Seasonal, but also coming on board as a helper, I really wanted to take the time to recognize some of the people that have really just gone above and beyond on their streams, people who have made the games just so much more exciting. And so that's why we're doing the Caster Awards today. Now, if it were up to me, I'd give every single caster an award because I love everyone, and I think we've seen just some really great quality stuff. But what we've done is we opened up a couple of categories to the community, and we've asked for their opinion. So we're going to do a quick rundown of these categories, and this is what we're looking at so far. Our first award is going to go to our most unique caster. Now, this is the caster that has really just differentiated themselves, done some really creative and unique things for their stream, and that's something that we wanted to recognize. So that's going to be our first award of the evening. Our next award is going to go to our best new caster. And this is something that we made a list of our casters who have streamed their first games this seasonal, people who are new to the team and have just done an exceptional job with their casts. We, of course, are going to recognize our Hype Master, people who have really just made games just that much more exciting to watch. And it takes a very special skill to keep these games exciting when it does slow down or get a little bit dull. So we're doing that as well. We also have our best production to recognize someone who has put in just a ton of work into making their stream look professional every single time. And of course, finally, our caster of the tournament. So lots of awards happening for today's show. The votes have already been counted. We have our winners here on stream right now, which we'll get to in just a moment. And well, in fact, let's just get into it right now. Let's jump into our most unique. So our most unique caster is one that really stood out from the crowd. Now, this is one that really spent a lot of time making sure that their stream was different than the rest of the crowd, because with so many casters, I feel like it's really hard to kind of stand out and show how you're different. But the community has voted and has voted that this streamer has been the most unique and has been the most creative with their streams. Everyone, please welcome to the stream Beat Tony. Tony, welcome, welcome. How are you doing today?
Hello, Nitro. Thanks for having me here. I'm doing fine. How are you doing, my friend?
You know, we're doing all right so far. We're doing great. Very excited to see you in the final later today, which we'll get to here later on in the show. I want to talk about, you know, before we get into, you know, the games, I want to talk about you as a streamer because, you know, you had a really, really strong showing of support. And so I just want to hear your thoughts on, you know, being voted the most unique. And also just tell me about your experience casting seasonal so far.
So first of all, I want to say thank you to everyone who voted for me. I didn't have like that many matches I streamed. I think it was not, I think only two games. Mm-hmm. And yeah, but thank you guys. It's awesome that I just won this new award thing for Nitro. So yeah, and it was also, I need to say big thank you and big shout out to Kieran, my co-caster. He was always there, and I think it's like if we stream together, it's like the synergy between us, that we make a lot of fun, that we have like this good friendship between us. And that's, I think, a big deal if you have a co-caster. And maybe that's the point why I'm like unique, I think.
Yeah, I agree, because I think one thing that we're seeing more of is people really teaming up to cash these games. And I really think it's made a difference here. You know, I think you two have made a great team, and people seem to really be enjoying it. So I'm glad to hear that. And really, I want to see more more people team up for this co-casting, because you get two different perspectives, you know, whether you get two maps, which is always great, or even just the one. You know, people are finding a way to make it work. So so thank you for being on our team. We're happy to have you. And yeah, just congratulations on the win.
Thank you very much, guys. Thank you, Nitro.
Of course. Thank you. And good luck in your game today. And our next winner has won not one, but two awards today. Now, there are a couple different categories, you know, that we're giving out awards for. And because there are a lot of different things we want to recognize our streamers for. And one of those categories is our Hype Master category. Now, we all know Hell Let Loose has some really exciting moments, but there are certainly times where the game can get dull, it can slow down a little bit, and we rely on our casters to keep the stream fun, entertaining, and keep you interested in the game. And our next winner does a very good job of that. In fact, they've done so good of a job that they've won a second award voted by you, and that award is Best New Caster. So, without further ado, please let me introduce my friend and wonderful caster, Trauma Stu. Stu, welcome, welcome. Congratulations. How are you feeling?
Dude, Mr. Nitro, thank you very much for having me along, my friend. Like, I feel great. This whole experience of casting season has been amazing, and that a few people have come out and support and chucked a couple of awards, like, it genuinely makes me smile, my friend. Thank you.
No, I'm glad. Like I said, you've been fantastic to have on our casting team. You know, we have such a wide and diverse range of casters, and we have people from all walks of life, people with different experiences, different skill sets. And I gotta say, having been both a viewer and a guest on your stream, I can tell that I feel the energy on your stream. It's fantastic. It's just so much fun. And the production value, of course, is always just great. So it does not surprise me that that, you know, people come out to support and voted for you. So I just want to say congratulations and thank you. Anything else you want to say to the people?
Yeah, I would. Like, obviously, for anybody that came out and voted for this, just genuinely thanks. It's because of your support that I get to keep doing this, right?
Right.
And just for the people that rock up, like, week in, week out, every time, like, obviously, like, we hit some of the biggest viewer numbers I've ever had for seasonal. Part of that's people want to watch the game, but part of that's just people swinging by and going, hey, this is kind of cool. The fact that I get to review the VODs later and go, like, look over all the chat and just go, fuck, people are actually enjoying this, makes me want to keep doing it. The community for Hell Let Loose and seasonal specifically, it's probably some of the best I've ever had, like, the pleasure and the honor of working with. So I'd just like to say, literally, thank you to each and every one of you. Now, Mr. Nitro, do you mind if I say, like, I've only really got one way that I thank people around here.
Oh, yeah.
Around my channel.
Guest. Yeah.
That's a piece of footwear.
Okay.
This is a beverage. There's a thing we do in Australia. Now, what I like to do is combine the footwear with the beverage. Like, so I don't know whether you haven't seen this before, have you?
No, never in my life. No, this is the first time I've ever seen this, actually. Yeah, please explain.
So now, once they're combined like this, like, there's only one thing to say, and that's welcome to Australia.
Welcome to Australia, indeed. Trauma Stu, thank you so much for jumping on and talking to the people. That's a shoey. And just want to say once again, congratulations. Thanks for being you. Thanks for being part of our team. And well, we hope to see you again next seasonal.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nitro. And thank you to everybody else. You guys are amazing.
Thank you. And we'll see you soon. Now, our next recipient has once again not only won just one award, but two. And these will be our final awards for this edition of seasonal. Before we announce who that is, though, I just want to once again take a moment to thank all of our casters who put on so much work to give you guys a great show every single weekend during the seasonal. So a big shout out to everybody. I love the work everybody's put in. I love the collaboration. And people have just been putting on some really great streams. So a sincere thank you from me to you. And I just want to say to everybody, I'm glad to have you on the team. And without further ado, let's give out this award. So our first one is going to be for Best Production. This person had a professional looking and sounding stream every single time. And we want to recognize that person. But this person has also won our Caster of the Tournament. This person got the most votes for our number one caster this edition of Seasonal. And that person is none other than Das Altberg. Congratulations, Mr. Altberg. We do have a short message from him, so we're going to go ahead and play that for you now.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Winning not one but two awards for casting competitive matches in this seasonal tournament or fan and losers is truly mind-blowing. It's like, I don't know, it's like pumping iron and reaching the pinnacle of victory back in my older days. I want to thank the entire Head and Loose community, the developers, and my fellow casters for pushing me to the limits here. Your energy and passion fuel my fire like no other. Together we have created an unstoppable force, showcasing the intensity and skill of the game. To all the players, you are the real champions out there. Your dedication, teamwork, and grit on the battlefield are what makes this game truly exceptional. It's an honor to bring your fierce battles to life through my casting. This recognition is a testament to the power of determination and never settling for mediocrity. I promise to keep pushing the boundaries, bringing the most electrifying casting experiences in the gaming world. Remember, in Hell It Loose, we conquer together. And with this award, we have conquered the casting scene. Thank you for all this extraordinary honor. I'll be back.
So that is going to wrap up our very first edition of the Caster Awards for the Seasonal. Thank you so much to everybody who's voted. Once again, thank you to all of our wonderful casters, and we hope to see you all again next seasonal. Now, stay tuned. We're going to take a very short break and come back with a bit of a fireside chat with the seasonal org. This is definitely more of a podcast format type thing. So grab a snack, grab a drink. This is going to be a couple minutes, and by a couple, I mean it's a pretty lengthy discussion. So stay tuned, and we'll be right back.
Another flow.
What you want?
Don't be ready to go to another flow.
What you want?
Show.
And we are back. Welcome, everybody. And you'll notice right off the bat that I am not alone. We are joined by some friends today. Hello, everybody. Welcome, welcome. I'd like to introduce the seasonal org. That would include The man himself, Mr. Heidi. Hello.
Hello. Wow.
I know. We got the sound effects going today.
Mm-hmm.
To his right, we have the Catman himself, Schmitz Katze. Hello, Schmitz.
Hello.
And in your top right corner, that cute and furry little friend is Quokka. Quokka, hello.
Hello.
I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Is that how you say it? Quokka?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, it's not complicated. It's
okay.
Quokka, Quokka.
Nice. Yeah. And down on your bottom right, we have the person in charge of everything casting, design, artwork, and she does so much for seasonal. Hello, Jane. Welcome.
Hello.
My favorite, you know how you can have your status in Discord that you can set? My favorite one that I've ever seen from Jane, because Jane updates them quite often, I think the one that made me laugh the most in the last couple months, I think it just said, like, head bitch in charge, and that was hilarious.
That's my biopic, actually. That's not my status.
Nice.
What about the muffin crumbs?
And last but not least, the bot man, the stats man, the numbers man, Abu does so much for us. Welcome, Abu.
Oh, I want to stay silent until you've introduced me. Now I can talk.
Resident genius.
Yeah. We do have a few other seasonal org members who can't be with us today. First off, Magic Jokic, who is my wonderful friend and co-caster. He is away in Alaska for an archaeological expedition. It's super exciting. He's been away for a few weeks and has already found, like, I think a 10 or 13,000 year old, like, bison bone. So that's cool. He's doing cooler things than we're doing right now. So that's Magic. He is a great part of the seasonal org. And I think what we're doing is cool, Heidi. It's fun. It's cool. But I mean, a 13,000 year old bison bone is, it's pretty damn cool.
So.
Pretty old.
That's pretty old, yeah. Almost as old as Schmitz. So,
wow.
I know.
Wow.
Yeah. Anyway, and last Thank but not you. Least, the newest member who will be joining us in the seasonal org, but is not with us today, is Semeya. Semeya is great. I've played CSGO with Semeya, and he's
the French legend.
That's right.
Good.
That's right. Thank you. He'll be joining us. And before we get started, I do want to share some news. While we are getting a new member in our wonderful team, whom I love very much, we do sadly have to say goodbye today, because this is airing on the day of the final. We're saying goodbye today to the person who really is in charge of seasonal, you know, the man behind the curtain. You know,
wow.
Heidi's just the puppet governor.
Jesus Christ.
He's the face of everything, but he doesn't do anything.
Being discredited so hard right now, Heidi.
Yeah.
I'm doing nothing.
That's
obviously.
Right. Schmitz is the one running things around here. No, but Schmitz, we do sadly have to say goodbye. He is leaving us off to do bigger and better things. Yes.
Because he hates the Hell at Loose community.
Yeah. With reason.
Yeah, that's not a bad reason, honestly. No, but Schmitz is moving on from Hell Let Loose, so I just want to say a very big thank you to you, because you have been amazing and have helped us with so much. I just got on board the team, this edition of Seasonal, but from my understanding, Schmitz has been a big part of this since a very long time, so...
When did you join, actually, Schmitz? What seasonal was it? I actually don't remember.
The seasonal after Core lost against WTH.
That's really early on. That's like the second or third, right? Third?
No. That's like...
It's the fourth?
Fourth, I think, yeah.
Fourth, okay.
I joined for the fourth and the mod.
How many seasons have we had again?
We won first and third.
It's the sixth now. Yeah. It's the sixth season now.
Yeah.
So fourth, fifth, and sixth.
Yeah.
I'm getting old.
There have been quite a few of these things now. So, but no, we're here today, as the title implies, we're having a fireside chat. Just here to talk about the seasonal in general. We have a couple of questions from people that we'll be answering. But first, I want to talk about our finalists here. We have DC versus the Greyhounds, 116th. And this was something that I would like to point out, that on Mr. Doss Altberg's podcast, I called this like 6 weeks ago, that I actually called DC would win the entire thing. I think it's going to be close. After the semifinal game that the Greyhounds had, I think they were really impressive. And so I do think that this game, which we'll get to in a moment, will be closer than I anticipated. But just want to say, if DC wins this, I called this from like a long time ago. But no.
What if you're wrong?
If I'm wrong, then that never happened. Send the VOD, you know? This never happened. But I do want to talk to everybody about this edition so far, because we've had a couple of changes with the format, with the rules. And I want to start off with the actual format that we did for this edition. It is 11 weeks compared to, I think, what was it, like 15 or 16 last edition? It's definitely shorter than it was.
Check.
It's
Was it 12 or 13?
Okay. 12.
Wasn't it 13 after the like that week break or that extra week?
If you count the week break, it's 13. But I think it was 5 weeks first stage, 3 weeks second stage.
I have 15 weeks.
15.
Yeah. Okay. Plus 3 weeks of main week of main stage, and then 4 weeks playoffs. Yeah.
So as far as the format, I like this a lot. As far as dividing people into groups, I think it gave a lot of newer teams an opportunity to shine a little bit. And I think the feedback has been good from a lot of teams as far as the change here. And then you have the playoffs, where obviously from 32 teams, we have the top 16. I kind of like that staggered format where people who do very well in the beginning, you kind of get a break into even the beginning of the playoffs. But as far as everyone who's played, so I believe that's Heidi, Abu, and Quokka. What are your thoughts on the format as a player?
I think that it's worked out a lot better than last season, especially because you get every team involved from the first week.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no one like waiting like 2 months, like the top teams have to wait for ages in the previous format to start playing, which kind of sucks.
Right.
And you know, having the format also shortened is just really good as well. And the way that we sort of thought about like how to group teams and that sort of thing, like just bringing in that element of common sense into the equation and just sort of trying to keep groups as even as possible and trying to think of every eventuality. Like, I think we did a pretty good job of it in the end. But it took a lot of brain power to get there.
Yeah, I remember all the spreadsheets for the pools and getting everything set up and trying to figure out the schedule. That was quite a bit of time. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So. I mean, for me, there's multiple things. It's like Oka said, our seeding and everything was really good. I think the group stage was like basically how it should be, with like the teams that are supposed to get out of it getting out of it without problem, and then you know the. Like, you know, it worked as intended. One thing I'm not too big of a fan of, at least for the teams that will go 3-0 in their groups,
mm-hmm.
is this skipping stages, because it's kind of like, you know, we just moved basically the waiting time from being the before the seasonal to being in the middle of it, right? So it's mm-hmm. like...
Yeah.
In terms of momentum and stuff like that, it's kind of tough for teams that are like basically having quote-unquote easy games, you know, in groups, or at least, right. you know, where they're heavily favored,
mm-hmm.
and then they win because they kind of expected to, and then you jump, you kind of break your momentum, you do nothing for like 2 or 3 weeks, I don't remember, I think 3, and yep. then you have that game, which is an elimination game, you know, so at least right. for us... It was kind of tough to like motivate people and like try to do scrims, because it's not seasonal, so people don't really care. And then, you know, you jump into that game. You know, we still got it with versus ESPT, but it's like, you know, it's a bit weird. And also, it feels sometimes a bit maybe undeserved to be already in quarters if mm-hmm. you didn't play, you know, the earlier stages of playoffs. So if there is something... that I would maybe, you know, rethink for the next one is mm-hmm. finding a way that there isn't that skipping stages mm-hmm. feature in it. But it's kind of course, hard, because that's how it worked by, you know, you can have, of course, more teams if you have that sort of skipping, because then right. you need you know, you can have more teams getting into playoffs because they wait at the further stages and stuff like that. But anyway, if there's one thing to maybe rethink, for me, it's that. But otherwise, I really liked it better with the group stages into playoffs with everyone in the groups. But maybe that skipping stage things can be rethought. But that's otherwise, I think the format was pretty good. And it was interesting, yeah, that all the pool one teams were, you know, it's basically like our seeding kind of
proved itself. Yeah.
You know, it's like in finals we have two pool one teams. In quarter we had four, if I'm not mistaken. Oh no, except you know, in
except
famous,
for, right?
It's something
like FOC. Right.
I mean, something happened there.
Yeah. Right.
We all know something happened there that was a bit, you know, magical.
I think when you're looking at it from a seeding point of view, like just like that, you can say that, you know, it worked as intended, which is what you want when you're organizing a tournament in advance.
Yeah.
Right. You know, no, absolutely. I think that's something to think about as well, because if you really think about it, a team can win seasonal in six games if you go undefeated. And that's not a lot of games to win a tournament on. So I definitely agree. Yeah. I think a couple
and it's
more
like,
games. Go ahead.
The format for me is the best for basically the A tier of team, right? Like the best not to win it, but like to enjoy it and like full, you know, live up to your fullest potential in a way. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's also something to do with how Hell It Loose is, where like with very high level teams that are somewhat on the same level, it's going to be very dependent on map side layout deployment, you know, and stuff like that. And while if you play teams, you know, that are not really in your tier, these things matter less because you will usually, you know, usually the favored team will win.
Right.
So there is a lot more teams that are that fit into that A category, you know, that were like the teams that went 3-1, 3-2 in the groups, and then that get to fight it off in the early rounds of the playoffs. And I think for these teams, it's like so nice because you play basically the whole duration of the seasonal.
Right.
You make it, you know, you try to make it as far as possible. You have a chance to make it to the finals, you know. But then for the lower teams that just get destroyed in the groups, it's a bit rough. And for the higher teams, like I said earlier, it's a bit weird because you kind of win easily, do nothing, and then have three big games, which kind of sometimes feel a bit way more swingy and less of a chance to prove things, you know what I mean? So
right.
That's just also what Hell It Loses, you know, and we can't really escape that, you know, it's just what it is.
Yeah, you can only do so much to kind of help out some of the newer teams, I feel like. But no, I agree, though. I think that this format gives a lot of teams a chance to at least do well. Even if you don't make it to, like, top four, you know, a new team still has the opportunity to make it pretty far into the playoffs if
and
they are practicing.
And we've seen it with Bad Company, for example. It was their first time playing in the seasonal, and they actually went quite far. Even if you ask them, at least at the beginning of the seasonal, they weren't confident they would go so far. So it was really nice to see that they were given a chance to prove themselves.
Yeah, no, I think we've seen that with a lot of teams. I mean, we saw GBI make it to the playoffs as well, you know, first time in seasonal. I'm trying to think of other teams that also went pretty far. I believe KRT had a decent run as well. I don't remember if they made playoffs or not, but... you know, a lot of these teams that had their first time here, you know, they really proved themselves. And I think that's great.
KRT, it's not the first time. KRT are long-time friends of Seasonal, though.
It's
even
not their first time, but they're returning, right?
Returning.
Yeah, they're returning. But it's the first time as a full 50. They were always allied with other communities.
Yeah.
But yeah, they are, you know,
nice.
And we know them well.
Also to mention for KRT that they stepped up this late.
Yeah, and they were a last minute entry.
We had 32 teams.
Some pops. Yep.
Yeah.
The best.
That was really nice.
Yeah.
The MVPs of seasonal.
Yeah, honestly, though, yeah, they really saved us. So thank you, KRT. Well, I do want to get to a couple of questions that we had. We asked you, the community in seasonal, to give us your questions, things you want us to talk about. And in seasonal and just in general, HLL community fashion, we got a million troll questions. So thank you for that. First one I'd like to point out.
Answer the troll questions?
Yeah,
Can we get the best of the trolls?
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So number one on the list, someone named Abu, whoever that is, asked, when do I get a raise?
Never, Abu. When I do.
Wow.
When I do, you do. It's no, it's trickles down economics.
Yeah, yeah, true.
FYI, he's unemployed.
Wow! I'm a stay-at-home dad without children, you know.
No, you have your little fur baby. Yeah, absolutely. So
don't talk about Jane like that.
Oh, fuck you!
That's getting a little spicy.
Getting spicy there. Yeah.
A little bit. Next troll question from Nasorin. Where are my car keys? Do most people in Europe...
I stole them. I'm sorry.
Good one. It's probably in your other pocket.
Ah, that's
the left
where
pocket
it is.
Instead of the right. You always check the right, but send the left.
Do you keep your keys in your left pocket? I usually keep mine... Or in your right... Mine are usually in my left.
You always keep your keys in your right pocket because you're holding them in the right hand. Then when you go to the door, you're holding something in your right hand. And then you got to dig into your right pocket with your left hand, and it's just very annoying.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I need to change what pocket I keep those in. That makes logical sense. Yeah.
I don't go outside, so I don't know.
That's true. I was going to ask, do people in Europe drive cars often, or do you use public transportation more?
Don't start Nitro, please.
No, cars in Europe.
I know there are cars in Europe. I know this.
You did ask me the other day, you know, if we used fire... What's the name? Oh my god, I can't remember. The thing on the road.
Oh, stoplights. Oh, I asked if you had stoplights in Europe. Yes. I learned that yes, you do. So
that's
yeah.
No, but honestly, that makes sense because you're a Belgian person. You don't understand. But in France, if you don't have a car, you can't survive. That's a good question.
Thank you.
Yeah, in Belgium, public transport is really good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In big cities, usually public transport is going to be quite good.
I see.
But then if you go into more the countryside, it gets less and less good in the swamps.
Ah, okay. Yeah, that makes sense. And that's kind of what I figured. I figured in the big cities, it'd be, you know,
you're
going
to have to
cars.
Censor him if you don't want to get shit on your stream.
And there's Netherlands. We don't talk about the Netherlands.
Where civilization is, it's okay, you know. But once you know, you stray away, further away from God.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Up in the countryside. The last troll question we'll get to is from Jane, and she asked, "How are you so sexy?" I want to know who that's directed to.
I think all of you.
It's not. That's definitely at all of us. Yes, absolutely. And the answer is, we're just born that way. You know, you can't help it. So. No, but all seriousness, though, I do want to get some questions that people actually have that are genuine. So the Fat Egg did ask us, what was your personal favorite match to watch this edition? I can answer that right off the bat to give you guys a moment to kind of think about this. Other than the last 10 minutes of the Infamous and FOC match, because that match was boring, I think, up until the end. But the ending was one of the most exciting that I've seen this edition. Overall, I'd say the most exciting match for me was actually, this might be biased because I'm in TL, but TL versus SGN. This was on St. Mary Glees, and the point, I believe, was on Hospice. And this came down to the final maybe minute of the game where SGN had control pretty much the entire game. TL came back in the final seconds to capture mid, finally boxed out SGN after the entire game they're failing to do so. It was just a really, really great comeback, and it was just a good game for TL. I think they were eliminated a couple weeks after that, but very exciting game, very close, and it's those moments, I think, that really make it exciting for me.
And for me, that was really last 10-minute meta. Like, it's like games feel like people play for the first 10 minutes, then they AFK for an hour, and then they play for the last 10 minutes. You know what I mean? It's
that's so true.
And the... for me, it has to be the Banzai, you know, fuck FOC. It's just because in a way, I think I don't want to start trash talking anyone because, you know, WTH is bad. But Inf kind of threw it. They kind of got punished for playing a bit too static, I would say, you know. And how, no matter how solved Hell It Loses, there's still some. It moves, there's still some way if you go full W, no care, and you push. And you know, nuts. There is a way to break even Foy's Southern Edge, you know. You're just type Banzai in comment chat. I love it. That was the best moment for sure for me.
That was great. No, absolutely. We go to Schmitzkatze. Favorite game that you can remember?
As I watched really all of them, it's not that easy. I mean, stream-wise and fun-wise, I would say both Fins That Lose against KRT games,
But also KRT against Greyhound game was a nail biter in the end, where Greyhounds nearly threw it.
Yes.
Other than that, yeah, I would say those games, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
KRT games were really fun, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Very fun team to watch, absolutely. Quokka, we go to you.
That's a hard one. That TLSGM one was amazing. I remember watching that. But for me, and I'm slightly biased here, it would be the Phoenix GBI game round of 16. That was a 5-0 for GBI in the end, but it was a really tight game throughout. And like, for me, it's just the way, like, that was the game where GBI really announced themselves and, you know, sort of showed what they were, you know, really made of. And I was, you know, very pleasing as a OC member to see another team come up like that. So yeah, that was a really cool game.
Yeah, I think OCE really showed up this edition. I mean, we had a lot of teams from a lot of different regions. I feel like for a couple of editions, EU has been really dominant. But now we're seeing other teams really step it up. And we had FOC in the quarterfinal. Excuse me. Did they make it to the semis? They did, right? Yeah, they made it to the semifinal.
Yeah, by beating Inf.
Yep. And then we had OCE, Chimera, GBI both doing really well. And so it's kind of great to see teams from other regions kind of step it up and really prove themselves. NA, you know, not their best edition of seasonal for NA. That's okay. We can come back. There's a lot of new teams up and coming, so that's good.
Who's the best team in NA, like according to seasonal? Who's number one NA?
Right now, I think.
How did they lose at the same, you know?
It's got to be Esprit de Corps because they got eliminated.
They went quarter.
Yeah.
ESPT, yeah.
ESPT, I think. They definitely hold
ESPT
number
one
NA. That's a hot topic for NA teams. You know,
it's tough.
Being number one NA. Yeah. No, it's
Yeah,
it's
tough to be number one something.
Yeah, no, that's true. But Jane, we go to you. Most memorable or favorite game so far this edition?
Yeah, so I am a chauvinist, right? I'm French. I have to be. And for me, the one I was really expecting was DC versus Refuse, because I used to be part of ARK, which is now Refuse. And I was just so glad to see them go all that way. And yeah, I wanted to believe, you know. So that was very exciting for me to watch.
No, that was a great game as well. I didn't get to watch that one live, but I got back or got to watch the VOD after. And yeah, no, that was a really, really good game. Very fun to watch. So, and last but not least, Abu, we'll go to you. Favorite or most memorable game?
Last but not least, I'm not sure about that. I don't think I've watched any games. I remember watching like half an hour of, I think, the second Finns at Loose versus KRT game. I think I've watched back the Fog versus Inf as well.
He just does the numbers, doesn't give a shit about anything else.
Because people, everything else is just completely gone under the radar for me. Like,
well, I think we can tweet the question then. What was your favorite game that you played in? Was it the Greyhounds game? Because I saw the arty from that game, and were you frontlining that game? I believe I saw you on hard cap a couple times, right?
I fire flares into the air.
Ah, yes, that's right.
And then respawn.
Yeah. So would you say that was your favorite game then?
No.
I see.
All I know is that wasn't my favorite game. Honestly, the rest is all so long ago, except for the ESPT game, but that was night. And I remember during the game, I had to constantly tweak my filters and stuff in the hopes to get more than 50 FPS.
Right. Yeah, that game was awful to watch, by the way. Who had the final ban, by the way, for that Hurricane Night match? Who had final ban? Was that WTH or was that ESPT?
Who knows?
I don't know. Either way, shame on that person, whoever picked that map.
Nobody
here
does bad phases here.
I see.
I don't know. It's not me.
ESPT had the last ban.
They do. Well, shame on you, ESPT, because wow, I could not see anything. And I was in the game. I can only imagine on stream. So anyway, we'll move on to our next question here. And that is, what do you like to see for a pregame show? This was a question from Buffinator, actually, one of our lovely casters. And I think this is great, too, because I do want to point out, and we talked about this in the caster awards earlier in the show, that it's so great to see the increase in effort and quality in production that we've seen from our casting team. And that's really why we wanted to recognize them. But since we do have the seasonal org here, what are your favorite things to see in a stream before the game? You know, whether it be interviews, highlights. We'll start with Abu this time. What do you like to see in a stream?
Well, I think the current like things offered are already quite good. I'm not that I watch many streams again. Mm-hmm. And you stop DMing me. Stop. Can't focus. I think it's really good from what I've seen so far. The little. I'm like, my God, stop it.
Heidi, would you like to share your notes with the class?
I'm going
to
block him. One sec. I'm going to block him.
Yeah, no, please do. Yeah, please block the disruptive kid. Okay. Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
He didn't be saying I was talking too much, so
that was
I had to answer.
15 minutes ago.
Yeah, well, I'm playing that match.
That boils down to what I was trying to say, because I think one thing that I personally prefer, I'm sure others will maybe think differently, others will agree, but I think stuff could be a little shortened up, as long as it's powerful enough, you know what I mean?
Right. So you're saying that this pregame show, I should just cut it all out, shorten it then?
Yeah. No.
I'm just kidding.
Just means I need to stop talking as long.
I do agree that I think whatever content that you have, you know, for a pregame show, as long as it's keeping viewers engaged and is interesting, I think that's great. I do think you can run the risk of maybe dragging things out a little bit too long. And that's something that I try to be aware of if I am planning anything. So I think that's a good point. If it's going to go long, make sure it's interesting. Otherwise, short and sweet is usually fine, I feel like. But Jane, we'll go to you since you are in charge of all of us casters. What do you like to see in a pregame show or pregame content?
You say that, but with my professional travels, you and Schmitzkatz have been handling the boat for the last 3 weeks. So thank you for that. It's not true, but yeah. So I would kind of pretty much say the same as Abu in the sense that for me, what's interesting is the variety, as long as you keep your audience entertained, of course. Mm-hmm. I really do appreciate that different casters have different perspectives on this. My personal preference, however, would be something that I really appreciate in the stream and something that I first saw with Lapino, actually, is map analysis pregame. Mm. I appreciate to see that the streamer actually knows what they are talking about.
Yes.
And it's not exactly pregame, but I think that having a dual cast is very interesting to have several people talking about their analysis of a game. It makes it more dynamic, more enjoyable.
I agree. Yeah, 100%. And actually, that's one thing that I think we've seen a lot more of this edition as well, is we're seeing a lot of casters team up for a dual cast. And that's fantastic. Whether you have both admin cams or even just one, both admin cams obviously is the best format, just because you can see both maps at the same time. And that's wonderful. But people are making it work even with just, you know, one admin cam slot. And that's great to see. So, yeah, I think more collaboration and having someone that, and this was described to me best by, it might have even been Heidi. That you have kind of your play-by-play guy, and then you have your color commentary person. Yes, exactly. And we've seen some really great combinations for that. So I think that's fantastic for these casting teams. But we'll go to Quokka. As far as what you like to see, what are your thoughts?
Well, I'm afraid that I have to disagree with I'm afraid I'd have to disagree with Jane on this one.
Okay.
I don't like the map analysis stuff at the start. I'm sorry.
Okay, that's okay. Everyone has their own, you know, favorites.
Yeah, I guess there's things that, like, focus on the teams themselves, like nothing too long, like Abu said. I really like streams where you have multiple casters as well, just for people to bounce off each other. I think it works really well. But... yeah, like, just in terms of, like, before game stuff, like, I'm not about to tell, like, casters, like, what they you know, should do or to do, because, like, they already put so much work in for, like, very little, like, reward anyway.
Right.
But, you know, like, it's nice to see something that focuses on teams, like, you know, if there's possibility for interviews or anything like that, or just, like, highlights, like, as you said, like, yeah, that's always really cool to see, but... yeah, like, I'm not that fussy about it. Like, I'm just glad to have a game streamed at the end of the day.
True. Yeah. And that is one thing that we've seen has been tough in seasonals past, just making sure we have enough casters to even cover games. I think this edition as well, you know, weeks one and two, we had like 16 games to get coverage on. And that is so hard to get casters for, Jane. I don't know how you did it, but you managed to make it happen. So that's great.
It's a lot of DMs.
Yeah, I bet. That's one thing that I'm not sure people realize, that as you know, once you're on the team, you're going to get a lot of DMs from a lot of people. And that's just something I've had to get used to, I think, in my first edition being on the team. So, Schmitzkatze, let's go to you. What do you like to see before a game on stream?
I'm also on the, or I have the same, what's it called? What's the name? My English bad now. Opinion. Yes. Opinion like Quokka, that the pre-map analysis, I did it myself when I streamed, and it gets boring really quick, and I don't know, I took 5 to 10 minutes every time, but it's always the same, because the maps don't change, the meta don't change as much, and everything. But what I do like for this seasonal, I believe it was Critical Fail.
Okay.
He did like a 2 or 3 minute small video for every map that he covered, and did fly around with the cam and did talk about the map a little bit, and that's awesome, I really have to say, because I mean, the games will always start the same, more or less, yeah? 3 trucks, 4 trucks, 5 tanks, whatever, and they all, let's go on the point. Yeah, and maybe what I do want to see is something like, I mean, I won't see it, but that people do a little highlight reel of, let's say, if Greyhounds plays against DC on, oh God, what map do they play, guys, help me.
Utah Beach.
Utah Beach, yeah, and I mean, it's not the first game that Greyhounds plays Utah Beach or DC plays Utah Beach, and maybe add a little highlight reel, like 1 minute each or something. Hey, they did this last time, or when they played against whatever team, they did this, and they started here, and da-da-da-da-da, something like this. But really, really short, yeah, because if you do like a 20-minute map analysis, it gets boring, and people will just close the stream or mute it and go on and do something else for the next 20 minutes, and then, yeah, something like this would be really cool, I believe.
Yeah, as someone who doesn't really play comp all that much, I always describe myself on stream as like I'm just a casual viewer. I love to watch Hell Let Loose. The map analysis is really for me, like it's not my interest, because I feel like a lot of comp players know what to do on these maps, you know, a lot of the top tier teams
that's
in particular.
That's exactly the thing, you know, in your audience, you might not necessarily have people that are experts of a game.
Yeah.
It's not only players that watch the streams is what I'm trying to say. When you look at it, there's quite a big audience, and we've had quite a few players that actually started Hell Let Loose because they found it. So they found the stream. So for me, it's more about the experience for everybody, and that's what I find interesting in the map analysis, because you might not know this part of things. But I understand that for a seasoned player, of course, it's not interesting.
Oh, that's true too. Yeah, I think for new players that makes a lot more sense, and I think that's a good thing to point out, is that, you know, these streams bring in new players, or at least introduce people to the comp scene. I've had people that have come and chat during a stream, and they're like, "What is this?" You know, and people in chat will explain to them, and that's always so cool to see that, you know, someone would just discover, you know, seasonal that way. So that's always super interesting. But we'll finish this question with Heidi. As both a player, co-caster, and a viewer, what do you like to see in the pre-match show?
I mean, you know, even in like actual esports, the desk segments, like you can always see viewership like hard decline, you know, because people basically tune in for the games, right?
Right.
So I think it's basically like it has to be something that has a really additional value for people to actually want to tune in, and not, like you said, kind of just you know, wait for the game to start.
Right.
And I think, you know, you can either go full, you know, chilling, you're talking with your co-caster because you know that, you know, people watching there are also, a lot of them are, you already know and are your friends, and, you know, just chilling and don't put too much work into it. And otherwise, and that's perfectly fine for me, you know. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, I think, like, a combination of what you guys said, Jane and Schmitz, like, very team-specific plus map-specific things to be looked at, mm-hmm, is interesting, because in, you know, in Heretlus, these, like I said earlier, like the moments that are critical are sometimes very, very small, even if it's a long duration game. Namely, deployment is sometimes what really separates, you know, what makes or breaks a game. So I don't know, for instance, like Schmidt said, if you played that map before, like a small reel of you talking over, let's say, Utah allies deployment, that happened throughout the seasonal. Okay, teams do this. Oh, we can see some teams prefer to favor, I don't know, going to Grandma's house here on the map rather than going there, you know, but like seeing it with actual of this edition deployments, for instance, you know, that's stuff that's actually interesting even for just players, you know, to see, because you don't necessarily do all that prep and scouting yourself, you know, if you're a player. So, like, I think stuff that actual players would like to see is nice. And other than that, you know, just chilling. And like Jen said, just some stuff to introduce people to what the hell they're watching.
Yeah,
is also good to me. Like, yeah, I'm pretty kind of whatever the casters want, to be honest.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think people have done a really good job of making themselves stand out and being unique in their own ways, and I think that's great to see. Everyone kind of has their own thing for both before, during, and after the match, and that's awesome to see. I agree. Everyone has their own flavor, their own taste, but it's good to get some thoughts from everybody on, you know, kind of what you like to see. So thank you for that. We will finish with just one more question, and I can kind of answer this question, but I'm going to put a little spin on it. And the question is from Snip, and it was, will there be a rework of rules, like the you know, the one arty gun rule? We're going back to three guns. I believe the short answer is going to be, we're probably going to have a vote on it at the end of the seasonal. I don't want to speak for Heidi, but that's probably what's going to happen.
At the end, though, that's like...
You think
not, like, at the end of the seasonal, like in preparation for the next years.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. So the question, I'll spin it then, is after seeing an entire seasonal with the one arty gun rule, how do you personally feel about it? And we'll start with Quokka this time. Yay or nay on the one arty gun?
Well, I've got two takes on it. Okay. One take, as a Chimera player, I did not like it. Because Chimera is a team that really built a lot of its success, and we found a way to differentiate ourselves from other teams is just through those sort of mini games, those sort of meta games. Like, we put a lot of emphasis on getting, like, a, you know, good group of Rocket guys together, and like they put a lot of work into that side of the game. So when that sort of went out the window with the one arty rule, like, our reaction was sort of like, oh, well, fuck. Like, you know, we're now on a level playing field with a lot of these other teams that, you know, might, you know, have a lot more experience than us in the game. So, you know, how are we going to fare? So from that point of view, like, not a fan. But as we played through it and, you know, watching the games, watching how the games progressed, I am a fan of it. I think that the way that it has affected the game is not as drastically terrible as a lot of people thought it was going to be.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, yes, there have been, like, the games are sort of stalematey, but I don't think that's the one arty rule. That's just the way the Hell at Loose has sort of progressed naturally.
Yeah.
And the fact that it's sort of taken a lot of pressure off a lot of the teams in terms of preparation time as well. Has been huge. Like, if I compare the amount of time that we spent preparing for a game this seasonal compared to last seasonal, like, it's different. And it's different also in terms of what you're preparing. Like, you can spend your time focusing more on the more on like the game in general, the game at large, your tactics, how you're going to approach it, how you're going to approach different situations, rather than focusing on how the fuck we're going to build X amount of barricades, X amount of wire, whatever the fuck we're going to do, how we're going to get the rocket guys over here and get them explosive ammo and keep them firing, what are we going to do with these guys if we lose a point or cat the point, like all these things that are really focused around like four or five people on the map rather than the other 44 that are playing. Like it's like when you break it down like that, it's kind of insane that that's where it got to. So it's really nice to see that just this change in the rules has sort of gotten rid of that, and we're able to focus more on the parts of the game that, in my opinion, matter more.
I think I'm 100% in agreement with you there. Me personally, I love the change because the dumbest thing I have ever seen in a Hell Let Loose match, and I'm going to call out both the line and ESPT on this, was an artillery gun on top of a radar dish. What even
oh
is
my
that?
God, I remember
that's
that.
So dumb. Yeah. And so I'm glad that the one artillery rule has basically eliminated that. So just to eliminate the cheese, get back to actually playing the game and trying to, you know, focus on capturing the points.
I think that was actually quite funny.
It was funny.
It was amazing.
But wow, that was so dumb. And I think this rule has essentially alleviated that. So that's my take on it. But yeah, we'll go to Abu next. What are your thoughts on the one artigun rule?
I mean, if it means I don't have to run into barbed wire and like run like kilometers with a satchel and get shot like as I'm trying to place it like for 90 minutes straight.
Yeah.
I think that's an improvement. I'm a bit biased, maybe. I mean, now I'm flaring. Okay, I'm not like that's much better anyway. Like,
yeah, just a slight shift in your job.
At least you're where everyone else is.
I think it's an improvement. Think it's an improvement. Yeah, it does remove some room for opportunities. Like, I think on maps like the more dense a map is, and you say like Hill for Hunted, I think like squad tactics and stuff are more important there, like on maps like Purple Hot Lane or Remagen or anything that's so open, really, really funnels people into one line.
Right.
I think like having a good strategy to take down enemy arty, or the enemy not having a good strategy, could really make such a big difference in how one match on one of those maps played out, and it could make them more dynamic. Mm-hmm. Which is something that kind of lacks, I feel, on these maps now. I mean, like, we kind of lost against 116 on Purple Lane last week, and we just banzaied, or we tried to banzai our game, essentially.
Yeah.
Didn't work out.
No,
but yeah.
Okay.
It's a positive, but some maps are just more predictable now, I think.
I think that's fair to say. Absolutely. You know, with you kind of know what lanes you have to cut off now with, you know, with the arty.
Yeah.
All right.
I do want to say that the biggest travesty that we've seen this season was that we have not seen how the one arty rule will affect a game on Remagen. So,
I know. It's a shame.
Big sad.
There was an opportunity for the final. Yeah, DC.
It's a blessing.
Well, a quick note on as far as the Remagen game, we are going to be doing a charity match on Remagen next weekend, so that'll be fun. So, anyway, we'll go to Jane. One artigun rule, thoughts on that? In favor, against it?
Well, it's not that I want to say that my opinion doesn't matter since I don't play comp anymore, but I wouldn't say that it's the most relevant. But I have kind of a contradicting opinion in the sense that for me, I experimented it in the Sweaty Thursday, actually.
Okay.
Never did it in a comp game because I stopped comp before that. Mm-hmm. But in Sweaty Thursdays, we had this desire of having the same rules as in seasonal, you know, for best training possible for every team that is involved in that. And I played most of the games as recon, and as spotter. And I remember that when I used to play recon in comp, I actually quite appreciated to be able to go to the RT, snipe people, and I really had fun in preparing my games, trying to find spots where I could snipe them without being shot myself. But that being said,
That's honestly no longer how anti-arty worked in comp.
Yeah, I know. Like I said, my experience is outdated. But I mean, if I put myself in the shoes of an infantry player, like that must be such a relief, such a breath of fresh air, and not to die 15 times on your OP because because you have a dedicated arty gun pointed at you, like that's just so frustrating. So I guess it's good, but to be honest, I didn't see the benefits myself
in
my non-comp experience. That's
okay.
All.
Yeah, I just didn't get a chance to kind of test it in a comp setting. Yeah, I understand that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
One of my favorite comments talking to some infantry players, some different teams, was that with the one arty gun role, if I'm getting artied, I'll take it because that means the rest of my team is not getting artied because they're only artying you right now. So it's kind of that sacrifice you make as the one player is going to take it now.
Well, I mean, that works except when there is only one way to get in the point, you know?
Yeah, that's true. Like you sound like you're speaking...
Bushway, for instance.
Yeah.
I'm taking the arty, but it's not like they can go anywhere else, so, you know.
True. That is true. Well, Heidi, let's hear your thoughts then about the one arty gun role. How's your experience been?
Honestly, I think it's bad, but I think no rule is even worse. But I think this is really bad as well. I just... it's a bit like a negative comment, but for me it's like arty is just so insanely stupid in both of its forms. Like for me the previous meta was awful for all the reasons, you know, we've described here, which is like all the prep, all the blah, blah, blah. The fact that small edges can be so impactful while, you know, maybe the skill is different, you know, stuff like that. But the fact that you have this permanent artillery is also really also stupid, you know, because it also blocks a lot of the, like Abu said, like opportunities, possibilities and stuff like that. So it's just like, for me, we will probably, like you said, we will not do it just by default. We will go again through council and stuff like that, you know. We have to see exactly how, like the formalities, but so it will be put back on the table. And another thing is, you know, you all said, oh, cheese is gone, but I feel like people have invested a lot of time now in other types of cheese.
Yeah.
And the cheese we saw, namely, is like, first of all, truck snipes, which is something I also want to bring to the table with the council because it was talked about before. But, you know, with the one arty rule kind of taking all the space of the discussion, it didn't really, you know, take off.
Right.
But I kind of want to bring it like because we've experimented arty rule now, so the discussions are like healthier, right? But I want to see if we can do something about truck snipes, which are incredibly annoying on a lot of maps, and like also do that thing where you're like, okay, this side is determined by can they snipe our trucks or not. And like, for instance, like there is a bunch of maps where like, okay, on SMDM, I don't know, on Pierce Farm, I don't remember, whatever, someone can snipe the other one, on the other one the other guy can get sniped, you know what I mean? So it increases the RNG, the stupid RNG aspect of let loose layouts and deployments.
Right.
It kind of, I don't know, you know, so I would like to bring that to the table, see if we can do something against it, which would be quite easy to enforce because it would be basically say you cannot get a kill before
the
first
the
artillery,
whatever
the time is, but it would be, in my opinion, the best would be when the first artillery shell can land, you know? Like 23 seconds after warm-up wall, something like that.
Okay.
So that means something like that. I don't know. We have to find the exact thing, but basically, you know, you can get sniped after a certain limit because obviously, otherwise it's stupid. You can just stay in the truck forever, you know what I mean?
Right.
So it's like... just have a time limit, and before that, there cannot be a kill made, you know, which would allow some kind of, you know, leeway into more maps, maybe. So that's kind of my thinking is like, if we want to make Hallelujah actually a fun game, then there are also other problems that we could address, you know, that are the same kind of oppressive things in the meta, right?
Right.
Other than that, like, I don't know, it's still kind of bad overall. But it's just because we play a very bad game, you know? Like, there are a few unique things that we all love about Hell Let Loose. That's why we keep playing it, and that's why it still works so well. But the comp meta is really, in many ways, really fucked, you know? Like, the defender advantage, blah, blah, blah. All that stuff that we've known about for years is still just as true. I don't think it's more true in 1RT rule. If anything, we've seen some comebacks that I don't think we would have seen.
Right.
So I think it's even less, a bit less stalematey, but of course it still is extremely stalematey because of the power of MGs, the power of RT, be it locked 1RT or free 3 guns,
right,
the power of just holding angles, stuff like that. So yeah, my main conclusion is the rule is as bad as Hell Let Loose is.
Thank you. Thank
Which is pretty bad. That is,
something that is worth noting is that when the RT situation was brought up to the council, and then even after they made a decision, so, you know, like, as the staff, we don't take that kind of decisions. We make sure that the teams are involved and that they decide for themselves what it is that they wanna see in their comp situation. But even after the vote, like, the teams were really highly polarized against towards the decision. Like, some people were really in favor, some people were absolutely against, and it really wasn't that much correlated to their level. And so what we thought at the point was like, okay, well, let's take some time and let's see how it is going. Like, let's roll with it because it was voted, right? So democracy.
Right. Yeah. At the least vote we're trying. Happens. Yep.
Exactly. And then let's have a season to gather some data and see what's the real impact.
Right.
So, like Heidi said, it's going to be brought up to the table alongside other roles that might be discussed for the next edition. But at least now we have some data and some experience to base ourselves off to make a decision to either maintain it or leave it.
Yeah. No, 100%.
Yeah, that's one thing I didn't mention, but yeah, as I completely agree with Jane there. Like, as org, I'm really happy that we did it. Like, first of all, because it was just what was voted on, but also, like, that we said, okay, it's controversial, but doesn't matter. Let's do it. Let's try it. And I'm really happy that we did. And we see now, you know, we can have actually good discussions about what it does, what it doesn't. Do we want this or do we not for the future? But for sure, good that we tried and didn't go through another season of the exact same previous. For sure.
Agreed. Absolutely. Well, Schmitz, I know we have a lot that has been said already about it, but I still want to get your thoughts, your opinion. When are you going to roll? Is it here to stay? Do you kick it out? What are you thinking?
I keep it short. I love the rule personally. I was a RT death player beforehand at 116.
I see.
And all the prep you did to save the free guns and protect them. The streamer goes over it 2 seconds and everything's done. Yeah, there's nothing.
Yep.
All your prep work you did was destroyed by a streamer. And I don't blame the streamers, I did it myself. Every time this shit happens, the first thing I did was check the fucking RT dev because I hated it. Yeah. I hated this whole shit. And so I love the 1RT rule. I don't think that the kill counts or would have been different, mostly.
No.
And maybe the outcome of one or two games would have been different, but overall, I don't think if we didn't had the 1RT rule that it would have any different outcome overall in the season. So I liked it. Took prep time from a lot of people. I mean, Recons were fucked, yeah, because they are fucked the flare assholes at the end. Just shooting flares 24/7, but other than that, I believe you gave 6 or 7 more people fun.
Yeah.
To play the game, actually. So yeah, I liked it.
Agreed. Yeah, let's talk about banning flares next season, please. Let's bring that conversation to the table. So, but yeah, we thank you everybody for giving your thoughts. And we will
down. Fuck us, man.
So yeah, bad. No, seriously, let's bring it to the table. Council, ban flares, please. But no, thank you everybody for joining us today for this little fireside chat. We've been actually running for quite some time. I thought this was going to take like 20 minutes, but as with most Hell Let Loose shows. It ran a little long, but thanks for being here. Thanks for hanging out. Want to say a big
my comments.
Yeah, we'll just cut Heidi's comments in half. That'll bring us down to like 10 minutes. So.
Yep.
But I do want to say a couple of acknowledgments. Thank you to Schmitzkatze. We are sad to see you go, but happy to see you moving on to bigger and better things. And by bigger and better things, we mean like not the stress of dealing with everyone in seasonal. So so congratulations. Thank you. And
especially not Heidi.
I want to say a personal thank you to everybody for bringing me on board the team this edition. It's been a blast. It's been a pleasure. And also, one last time, want to welcome Samaya to the team.
Thank you, and it's
the best. Oh, thank you. No, not the best, but happy to be here. And of course, want to give Samaya one more welcome. Very excited to have Samaya on the team. Excited to have Magic Jokic back once he returns from his travels. And obviously, always glad to have Heidi, Jane, Quokka, and Abu with us. I think we have a great team. And seasonal, I think, has it's been going very well, particularly this edition. So anyway, that is not all the content we have left. You know, speaking of cutting shows short, we got more stuff coming. We're talking to our friends at DC and the Greyhounds. We're looking at the road to the grand final. How did they get here? We're talking to the teams they played against as well. So stay tuned. We'll be back in a few minutes. And thanks, everybody. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Hey. Bye, guys.
Hey.
To come, jump back to my
So hello once again, my friend Tony. Welcome back to the show. And for this part of the show, I really want to talk about how we got to this point. You know, this is the 11th and final week of the spring seasonal 2023, and you've made it to the grand final. So let's start with your very first game of the group stage, week one. You played OPBHB.
It was the first seasonal game, and we want to put everything there because we don't want to lose like the early games, because we had one big team meeting where we all just met in real life. So if we would have lost one game in the early game, I would say, then we would have not made this whole meeting. So it was a big pressure.
So I think it's nice to kind of get that momentum on the first game where, like, it goes really well, you feel good, and you probably feel good going into the second week. Is that right?
The second week was kind of tough. In the beginning, it was kind of like we get the mid-cap. We have, like, big mech control.
And yeah, the initial capture. There was the explosion, but it did not take out the tank.
And there happens, like, a little mistake. One of our snipers just shot the one artillery guy. So our whole team got a penalty, so 10 people got punished.
Big gamble contested. Profex and Doctor running over, taking down the garrison. That might be the end there. That garrison is going to go in a moment as well. Doctor takes it down in a second. It's not getting stopped. Doctor takes on the garrison. That might be... Oh! It could be both sides. KRG also...
We did manage to pull off a cheeky push from behind and take our second point back. We did cap hospice for the briefest of moments, and then 116 really identified that they were in danger, and they pulled everything back and swept us quickly away.
But sure, they're defending the point, and they're also taking hospice. Because hospice... What? What is this? KRT is captured!
You don't want to know how the people were screaming in the command shed, like, what the hell is going on? In the end, we just managed to get back up, and then we start and got hospice back.
You don't play another game again until week 5 of the group stage, and this game was ESPT, Esprit de Corps. Tell me about this game here.
We played well, we got the mid cap, and then after that, I think about a long time, we start to get pressure on the fourth cap.
All right, let's see. They've closed off the attack from cattle shed, or front door on cattle sheds by the looks of it. However, Breed Court. Wow.
Oh. Armor was not having a good game. We fought for gardens for like probably an hour. Did end up losing it eventually.
And in the end, we won 4-2-1.
Now, your next game that you played took you to Stalingrad. This was against EG, a Russian team, and really was the RP game of the season. What can you tell me about that game?
Well, we were kind of scared because we saw that EG is playing a lot of times Stalingrad, even as Soviet. And it kind of looked like it's a comfy pick for them. The guys prepared everything. They got in their buildings, in the top floors, the anti-tank guns.
So it was, as I think, a pretty close game. We captured the point first, but we can't hold it for a long time. They have pretty good infantry that pushed us on all front line.
Cormodini here. Not messing about. Got his MG42. Gets headshotted though. Takes down the commander first. But will he have seen that garrison? We'll have to see if Umika could get his mark up for us so we know it's there.
In the end, we got like this huge map control again. We built up so good, and then we had like the tanks carried us a lot in this game.
This tiger turns around, driver's going, oh shit, there's a tiger. There you go.
This brings you into the semi-final game against WTH. Tell me about Purple Heart Lane.
I think it was like the best map we could get against WTH. Because WTH is a really strong team. They have good shooters. They're like top tier. So going on a map where you can just force every single player and run single corridor is like a huge deal.
What I can say is, like, I mean, it was bad for us.
for me, it was kind of a weird feeling to play in the semifinal on Purple Heartland. Like I said, they played good. I mean, they made a good impact on midpoint with the looks.
Where's their anti armor? Oh, that was a massive artillery kill there.
So we've talked to the Greyhounds about their journey to get to the grand final. Now it's time to talk to their opponent. I'd like to welcome Soul Raver, Mike Lowry, and Havald. Welcome to the show. How are you guys doing today?
Thank you.
Good, thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Hello.
So your first game was in the group stage, week one, and you played 501 España.
The opener from them, I think we went through the north, and they just weren't there at all.
Yeah, there were nobody where, basically. We could go to the next point immediately, I think.
Yeah, it was a really, really weird game.
Oh my god! Oh, that is the biggest spawn wave I've ever seen. And how is Mike just still alive?
I don't know what happened with 501 this game. They didn't really do... I don't think they really practiced, to be honest.
Getting that first win took you to week two, where you played the Circle. What do you remember?
I remember
grinding.
Grinding. But this game overall, it was Circle did put up a good fight. I think they increased their skill level a lot over the last few months.
Might have just got a satchel on there. We'll see. Let's have a quick look at this. No satchel. Raddy spawn pushes up. And DC. Taken the first cap here.
It's weird playing DC. When you play them, their confidence is crazy. I've spoken to some of their players, and you see it when you play them. You can kill one of their guys, but you're instantly traded.
Yeah, they did a good job, but once we'd capped Hugo's, it was kind of like unlucky for them, because the Hugo's like for Axis into dugout is like, it's so easy to hold. So once we got through that, I think it was just like there wasn't too much they could do.
Ninja on top needs to be careful, his feet don't get blown up. Would there be one? How he's surviving there, but there we go.
And this took you to Omaha Beach to play Sesh. Tell me about this game.
Disgusting.
Disgusting game.
Are DC, are they going to play it? Are they going to take the time here? Big artillery show.
We played this one really wrong, but
after we took the city, it went fine, I would say. After we put the garrison front, yeah.
Yeah, this was one of them maps where we kind of like, we knew that to beat Sesh, because like the ping, because their tanks are really strong, we knew if we like kind of won map bans, I guess, it puts at a huge advantage. Well, I think we played well this game, but I think a big part of it was due to the fact we got Omaha access.
3, 2, 1, boom. GG.
Your win over Sesh took you to the playoffs, and you actually got to skip the first couple rounds and went straight to the round of 8. So tell me about this match against Refuse.
I was in mid grind. You can see me dying in the river all the time. I think Outbreak even had my POV, and every time he looked at it, he saw me in the best screen, I think.
But you can see how it is down there with Soul River in the middle, in the barn, surrounded by a plume on the left of his... Tank all making his way in. Ah, glorious multi POV action. And right now DC is taking WN4, one tank down, and Solway also taken down as well.
It was very tough. They destroyed all of our tanks very soon at the start, so they got a very big advantage.
Anyways, this might be a fast one right now, because look at this. Look at this. Another tank down, there was the last Refuse tank on the hard point.
We have really nice control on this map, basically, because Ninja pushed north about the river, so they never could attack from the front to our point, and we just had to grind the whole city the whole time.
It was a good game, and we won 4-1, because winning 3-2 is just boring.
I think this was probably our... this or the FOT game was our strongest game.
And I think this will end in a moment with a 4-1. Yeah, I think we... Yeah, that's gotta be that, isn't it?
With that win here, that took you to the semi-final game. You're playing on Karen 10. Your opponent is FOC. Tell me about Karen 10 and how it went for you.
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed playing it, and they did well. The infantry, sometimes they were just... They're even saying they do the banzai charge, you know, against if they did it.
Steven, as you can see, just crawling here. Takes one, takes two, takes three.
The game last week is, you can see it's a very tough one. The DC has very good map control. Like after they control the midpoint and trying to push north back, and which is very effective because our point, the next point for us is Mount Halas.
Are we getting anything on Mount Halas? We are, and with a dangerous, I'm guessing that's Mike Larry, and it is the one and only.
I can't decide on who I think has been our hardest opponent so far. Is it like, it's probably Fock, to be honest. It probably was the hardest game.
That win secured you a spot in the grand final. Here you are. It's game day. What are you feeling about this game?
Well, I played the Greyhounds leg, I think, a lot of times when I think 20 matches or something. So it's nothing new. So I'm just comfortable with it, to be honest.
We're, I think, pretty confident because Utah Allies, I don't know why people still think Utah Axis is so much better.
I'm really nervous, man, to be honest. It's like Utah Axis or Utah Allies. It's like, who gets the first cap?
This game is either won or lost on the opener. So whoever caps it 3-2, probably expect them to win this game.
If you don't win, if you're second, you're actually just the first loser.
And we are live. All right. Hello, everybody. Welcome, welcome. Thank you so much to everybody who hung out with us during the pre-show. We had a lot of fun talking to a lot of different people. And we're kind of just getting ourselves ready and hyped up for this game. So once again, thank you for tuning in for that. Thank you so much for the hype train. I want to just take a moment for a personal note. That was absolutely incredible. I never thought that would happen. So thank you for that. But this is not about me. We're here to watch the grand final for the spring season of 2023. And I'm not alone today. Today, I am casting this game with my friend and co-caster, Heidi. Hello, hello. Welcome.
Hello.
How are you doing today?
Hello, hello. I'm doing great. I was going to say I'm very happy to be co-casting with you, which I am. You know, I wish I was playing, but I'm very happy to be casting if I'm not.
No, absolutely. I'm definitely glad to have you here. I think this is going to be a really exciting game. Both of these teams undefeated right now. Both teams 5-0. The winner today, this will be their first seasonal win, no matter who wins today. So that's exciting. But let's talk about the map here. The map is going to be, we'll get it loaded up in a second here. It's going to be Utah Beach. DC going to be playing as the allies in this game. We'll give our scoreboard a quick little test here. Looks like it is working. So DC playing as allies, Greyhounds playing as the Axis. Let's talk about Utah for a minute here, Heidi, because we do have a couple of minutes before the game. As far as the midpoints here, and before we get started, just want to check, you can see my screen, yes?
Yeah, all
looks
good.
Okay? Okay, good.
Yes.
All right, so let's talk about midpoints here. We have a WN4 here in the north as a possibility. We have the Chapel down to the south, and then that's going to be right over here.
Yep.
And then, of course, we have WN7 all the way down to the south. How are you feeling about these midpoints? Let's go one by one here. We'll start with WN4 at the top. As far as allies versus Axis, what are you feeling about this?
It's pretty 50-50, honestly. It's a very contestable point by both sides. I would say the allies approach is a bit better because, you know, as you can see, you have more cover. You have the house in the north there, which you can, you know, that people usually send people to, so you can control the whole northwest side from these windows. But at the same time, you know, the Axis trucks can get in quite fast through the hangar. You know, if they just rush in there, you can maybe get there without getting sniped or anything. And then, you know, if Axis wins the tank fights in there, then they can also take it. It's pretty 50-50, a slight allies advantage, but mm-hmm. pretty 50-50. And the big thing is about this point, and it's going to be the same for WN7, the one in the south, is that it's really hard to retake for both sides. Like you can see that it's completely open on the west, and it's completely open on the east as well.
Right.
It's even harder for Axis because of this uncrossable barbed wire, but like both sides, it's terrible. Like you 100% need to control what comp players usually call Grandma. Grandma's house, which is that house just where you're going, to be able to do anything, because then you can, you know, kind of send an attack from there, because if you don't have that flank, usually you are just, you know, kind of suiciding in the open, on the main front lines.
All right, so that's WN4. Let's talk
tell
about...
me if I talk too much.
No.
I watched the pre-show. I talk way too much. So just cut me off if it's...
No, this is great. I will only cut you off if the map is about to flip, which it has not yet.
Okay.
Because in true seasonal fashion, I expect this game to start late. So let's talk about the Chapel, though.
Maybe I remove chat.
Good call.
So Chapel is, in terms of capping first, obviously very ally-sided. Like, if you open your map, you can see that... we are completely, you know, on the allies' side. You know that it's like not in the middle at all. No, the chapel itself is like easily reached.
Right.
But the contrary to this is that Axis have kind of a better route to get into Grandma and to get into the town. So in a way, you as allies, you will cap first, most likely.
Right.
Most likely, because I know in a scrim recently, 116 actually capped first. As Axis, which, you know, against Refuse, like, recently, so they like practicing for this game. So it's I'm interested if it's I really want it to be Chapel, to be honest, to see, you know, what happens. But usually, at least historically, allies cap first, and then it's about being able to push Axis out of the city just south,
right,
and the control of Grandma is as important as for WN4, except it's not in sector for Chapel, so it's a bit more risky to go for that, you know, because it's just above the sector line, so you're not in cap sector. So yeah, so it's usually allies cap first, usually Axis has the city first, so it can be very dangerous, like, to get surrounded as allies. So you really need to, what people do usually is they send tanks in the circle, allies, you know, they send their, so they don't die to arty, and they send most of their infantry in the town so that they fight there and try to push Axis out. Mm-hmm. And if you have control of the town as allies and Chapel, and you contest the north so that they don't have it for free, you should be kind of safe. But it's a hard point to defend because the whole map is open, you know. But
I actually think that's why I like Chapel. I think as far as a spectator and a viewer, Chapel is one of my favorites to watch. It's just really great. It's exciting. I think WN4, WN7 are a lot more static, and it's just as a viewer, it's just not fun.
As a player as well, you know, like Chapel, you have. kind of a combination of everything of Hellet-Luz, right? You have that open field on the west where the tanks can make a push and you can kind of go full Vietnam in the Little River.
Right.
Or you can have actually fun fights in the city where you don't get beamed by MGs, you know, 500 meters away because you're actually in between buildings, you know?
Right.
So, for sure, Chapel for me is like the most fun point. And like, you're looking at WN7 now, which is like...
yeah. Let's talk about WN7. As far as allies versus Axis, who has the edge here?
Whoever artists the most enemies. Like, it's 50-50. It's about snipes.
Mm-hmm.
It's about truck snipes, which allies should have the advantage on, right? Because they have the Dune on the east.
Right.
So it's about getting in, right? And like sending your tanks in the circle, sending everything in, because whoever caps this first, unless, you know, their tanks really throw or they do some hard tactical mistakes or like, you know, it switches in the first 5 to 10 minutes. But, you know, if you actually cap first and have control,
right,
it's really, really, really tough for whoever, right?
Yeah, right.
And the one way allies, like the very important house is where Jarvan Hill is at the moment, which we call booze in WTH, and I don't know because it's like a wine store, but whatever. Mm. But that house can basically, you know, that's always the first house you fight for when you try to retake it. If you don't have that house, you can basically do nothing as allies, right? Because that house sees down into everything, into WN7. It sees the north, it sees the east, it sees... It is also just, you know, in front of the point, you know, yeah, all that approach. So it's like a critical house to control. If, you know, as allies, if you control that house, you can try, you know, to keep sending attacks through this trench line, which is going to be obviously farmed by artillery. So it's really tough, but that's what you need to do. Your other option is to fight for the city, which is like, you know, the south of Chapel, and try, there you go, to go down that crossroads, basically. And you take control of this big house, where if it's... They're practicing their snipes already. if it's that house, you know, the broken house, the ruins house here, if you take control of that as allies, because you're coming from the north, then you disable some of the most powerful sight lines from Axis, you know, which...
Right.
If they sit there, they can basically see everything with the MGs and like mow you down while you try to approach. So like, if you have a good flank north, if you control booze and then you kind of push W in the front line and try to overtake, you know, from the east, while they don't have, you know, their powerful MGs set up because you took them out with your flanks, you know, that in an ideal situation, it can work, but you know, it's still a small little compound in the middle of an open field, you know?
WN7 is definitely really, really my least favorite. Just because,
it's really tough.
Yeah, just playing in the hard... Getting to the hard cap feels impossible. Like you said, there's these control points that you have to have. The barbed wire just makes it just a pain in the ass. The barbed wire, I think, is the biggest detriment for this map, in my opinion.
I mean, they did change. You used to be able to cross it, you know? Now you...
Right.
Yeah, then they didn't change the amount of barbed wire, so it's like, yeah, you have 3 choke points and a half, and just you know, enjoy yourself.
Yeah, have fun, enjoy.
That's why, for sure, I hope it's Chapel. Like, if it's Chapel, it's gonna be a nice game, because if it's Chapel, you know, it's not like these map edge points as well, where you know, there is basically no north flank. Like, if you're here, you control that north house, then there is, it basically doesn't exist, right? You just have to look in front of you and south of you, and it's the same on WN7 pretty much, right? So when it's Chapel, teams are forced to play the whole map way more, and you see, you know, these wide garrisons that you will see on WN4 and WN7, so people can reflank, you have a lot of room to play, you know. If it's Chapel, you have to build F3 and F8, you know, and then, you know, there is a lot of interesting moves that can happen, which is obviously less the case on, you know, map edge points,
right?
Especially map edge points that are that, you know, open.
Right. Yeah. And let's look at these fields to try to get into WN7. It sucks. At least you have some trees.
I mean, you rely on your
tanks
a lot. You rely on your tanks a lot. But famously, 2-3 tanking is really, really tough. Like, tanking is all about, you know, getting information. So if you know what the enemy has to do, you can play around them way more, you know. Like, so it's, you really rely on tankers outplaying, or on capping first, you know, you cap first.
This is something
my
that
hot
both
take
teams...
of the day is that whoever caps first is going to win.
Yeah.
We will see.
No, this is something that when speaking with both teams in like the road to the grand final, which actually you didn't get to see because we're getting ready for this. Both teams seem to agree that whoever caps first, most likely they're going to end up winning. It's going to take someone probably having to throw in order to not win.
If it's Chapel, honestly, it's way more open. Like right. Chapel, for me, it's hard because it's a small circle that you can delete with artillery, and then the defending team, you can have less advantage. The tanks can be less annoying as infantry. You can have more ways to maybe kill these tanks as infantry, you know, than right. rather in these big open spaces. So, like, if it's Chapel, I'm not sure. Like, it could flip back and forth.
Right.
But, yeah, if it's Dublin 4 or 7, I think whoever has the best snipes, whoever has the best deployment,
mm-hmm.
Honestly, also, who has the most confidence and the most balls, in a way, to go for some hardcore plays into the circle, you know, to actually win,
mm-hmm.
actually cap first, are gonna, you know, most likely hold it. Oh, God.
Well, we are about to find out who's going to cap first because the map is flipping in about 40 seconds
hype.
Or so.
Let's go.
Let's get some hype in chat. We're getting ready for the grand final, DC versus the Greyhounds here. About 25 seconds. Heidi, once again, thank you so much for joining me for the game today. I'm very excited. Also, just want to say thank you for everyone in chat. Let's spam your emotes if you have them for your favorite team.
All sub to Nitro.
Yes.
Sub to Nitro, you're not the true Hell at Loose fan.
You know, trust me, there's plenty of good things to spend your money on.
No.
Anyway, let's get this flip going. We're going to get into a squad right now as we load in. Alrighty. Also, Heidi, if you didn't catch it. Oh, wow, that was a very fast map flip. Okay, never mind.
Oh, let's go.
All right.
It's Chapel.
It is Chapel. Let's go. Pog midpoint. Let's do it.
That's amazing. Great. And it's Hill 5 into Chapel into Down. That's interesting.
This will be
very tough for Axis.
This will be a really interesting layout here. All right. Let's do it.
That's basically the kind of the dream layout for allies. Because you have Hill 5, which is, you know, you can kind of instantly go from Hill 5 to Chapel if you're ever in trouble. You know, you don't have to defend like something on the other side of the map, you know.
Right.
And they have the opposite, which is downfields. But in a way, it's kind of tough as well because DC needs to spread out to be able to push, right? They can't push forward in a line
mm-hmm.
because that just leads up in that sector. But yeah, let's see that deployment. That's going to be...
No, this will be really interesting to see.
Let's make sure we catch any truck snipes. Like, I know... DC engineers, you know, the DC research and development center, you know, it's really on point. So
right,
I want to see.
Yeah, let's see what's going on here. See what the layout is going to be or what these armor deployments are going to be. We are going to get the light tank here coming in from the north. Looks like the medium tank is going to go straight up the middle to Hill 5. Recon tank looks like going toward the middle as well. We'll take a look at the Greyhound setup here.
Yep, probably have some snipe setup as well. You can probably find Kale somewhere in a tank alone, killing everyone from some stupid spot.
Well, it looks like down south we are going to have the Puma here from the Greyhounds. That's going to be ready to go.
It's not moving.
Not yet. Oh, maybe not. Okay. Well, it's there. It's ready for someone to get in. Truck's, of course, going to head down the middle here. P4 is ready to go. OPs in the trucks. Looks like another Puma heading up toward the north. And anything else for the Greyhounds? Oh, no. What is this?
Well, of course.
No! What are you doing?
He messed it up.
Oh.
Did he mess it up? Because he's dismantling it.
No! The cheese!
Yes, of course.
Oh, man.
Of course. They're trying to snipe trucks. I told you. You know. It is what it is.
Yeah, it is what it is. 30 seconds here until the wall drops. Alrighty.
Okay.
Let's see
these trucks. If there's any.
Yeah, we'll be ready for it here. Here's the AT gun, Nasorin here on that. On all these trucks are bunched up together too. Oh wait, no, this is all their just their armor here.
Oh, it's still like it's Napos.
Yep, let's see it. Here go, it guys. Comes.
The volley.
Yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 ATs here.
All the snipes are coming.
They are coming.
Snipes. Is DC getting sniped?
DC gonna move toward the chapel on their way, making it past Hill 5 here momentarily. Tanks are firing as well. That was really close. We're not seeing anything yet.
Here
from...
is the danger spot right across Hill 5 when you cross this. It's really
yeah, here they come. People getting out of the trucks now. SL is getting out as expected. Here comes the rocket volley, though.
Yeah, yeah.
From DC.
Is it hitting anything?
Not quite gonna hit, it
That's
looks
so
like.
Delayed.
Greyhounds are very late to this.
Might be the extreme rubber banding, not gonna lie.
Oh, yeah,
that,
you know what? The,
it happens
this new update.
That the trucks are like, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no, that. But you know what? Greyhounds, though, still gonna get early control or early capture progress on Chapel. Here come the Lukes. Shells are gonna start firing now.
Should be fine, should be fine.
DC looking like they are getting themselves on the hard cap early. Look at the amount of armor coming onto Chapel from yep. DC right away. You have the two Greyhounds and the Stewie. Trucks getting
yep,
up in the
like
front.
Discussed, you know. Yep, just trying to get that circle pressure with as many people inside these armored vehicles as they can, while Axis is pushing for the city itself. And they have way more people, so it might be rough for DC to hold on here. And they're also pushing down the creek, which should be arted to death most likely.
Yeah, the arty markers are down there at the creek, so I'm expecting to see these guys disappear off the map here momentarily. But yeah. No, Greyhounds dedicating a lot of resources down to the south, over to the north. Greyhounds also getting early control of Grandma's house. DC, not really in control of the north just yet. They do have a couple of players.
Yeah, yeah, but look, look, they have like three tanks in the circle, right? So they're still getting cap pressure in their favor. These people should die pushing. Yeah, they did.
Yep. Arty Mark still coming down. That Luke's is going to start pressuring, though. That may have been a truck that just went down there.
That's a good Luke's.
Now, that Luke's is going to be a real spearhead of the attack here. Second one is already pushing up here. Greyhound's going to be really aggressive with the armor. They should be aware with the amount of armor that DC has on the point, but we're seeing more things explode on the hard cap.
That's crazy. They're actually not going for recap at all. Like, they're just going full in. They just want to cap this first as Axis.
Yeah, both teams agreeing that first cap's so important.
Yeah. I mean, it's all about these two arts and this medium hiding behind the chapel. If this medium can take out the Luke's, you change completely the tide of this. Like, you make yourself safe.
Oh, 100%. This is still going DC's way. But I think taking out that that Luke's is going to be really... what secures it for DC here in the beginning. Greyhounds, though, keeping up the pressure in the south. Gonna be some heavy infantry fighting down here in the town.
Nice. Nozoran farming some points.
Yeah. Of course, this creek still getting arty to bits here, particularly at the crossroads. Rockets coming out from AT. It's gonna be medicine. That Luke's also firing into the hard cap. I think some... was that a light tank that just went down from DC? They lost something there on the southern part of the hard cap, but... it looks
the medium
like
is still alive, right?
That medium tank is still alive.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's going to be a 3-2 lead for DC. Now it's up to the Greyhounds to get themselves in control. We'll do a quick map check. Take a look at the garrisons and OPs. A couple of garrisons lined up.
That Gary in E8 is dangerous.
That's very dangerous. Haval putting an early offensive garrison down. Plenty of OPs
Haval
down in the
with
south.
The core stats.
true core member.
He's contesting already. Yeah, yeah. 116 is like, no, we're still contesting this, but they're pushing already. Like, if there's more people that spawn on that Gary, it can be really, could be really funky.
Yeah, no, 100%. This Puma is still in the back line for the Greyhounds. Has not had any pressure yet. It's been here for quite some time now. But yeah, as we look at our map, a couple of SLs already spawning on that garrison. Most of DC seem to be focusing here just on the hard cap, getting control of hard cap, getting control of the southern part of the map. Not a whole lot dedicated.
You can see Grandma is completely 116. Yeah, well, like I said, you know, it's not in sector. So in a way, as allies, you don't want to overinvest into defending that because Axis has kind of the advantage on it and you mostly lose players. But here, it really looks dangerous because 116 has heavy heavy presence from there that actually starts to cap.
100%. Yeah, they're already going with the recap. It looks like that SL is solo capping Drowned Field, so not a big issue yet. But what is an issue for the Greyhounds is the AT players lobbing some rockets toward the Lukes here. Greyhound still getting that capture progress. If they can take out the Stuart here, that's going to be huge. They need to get that out of the hard cap.
Yep. You can see they're getting the city as well. Like, they have the south pretty much completely theirs. Like, the more south is DC, but just in between Chapel and the town, like, they have all of this space here. They only have one OP.
Yeah, Kale wiping two OPs. Down.
Kale, Poggers, Kale.
Will he get Blanker and Flaxion? He is going to get one, Paramax and Blanker. He's going to get two.
It's too easy for Kale.
Too easy for Kale. Greyhound still making the progress, recapping Chapel.
Yeah, that's tough. Only Alexibos in Chapel.
Yeah, an MG player in there. Only one in the hard cap. DC starting to contest.
Can we follow Vadi around? Can we follow Vadi, please? He's just under you. Just under you. Just under you. He's right there.
Yeah, these are SL here from DC. Just holding the angle right now.
Baiting as always.
Yeah.
Classic Vadi fashion.
Yep, Vadi masturbator. Yep, now he's moving into the battle to join his comrades.
Let's go, Vadi.
And that tank is, that Stuart goes down now on the hard cap. DC still getting control once again though. As you look at our map here, flares are going out now. That attack completely
so they still
gone.
Have basically circle control, but it's really, really shaky. Like, they have nothing north. They're starting to reflank though from W and 4, which is exactly what you want to do.
Right.
Like, you don't want to fight them inside out. You want to reflank so that, you know, they're cut off in their attack. They're trying to go Chapel, but they have to look north, and that's, so that's really good. And it should be annoying enough so that, you know, Anotisin has to deal with that push instead of attacking Chapel, you know?
Yeah, no, 100%. This is going to take people off of the hard cap and focus Greyhounds onto this northern part of the map. So good amount of resources dedicated to this Grandma's House push. DC getting themselves back up into the hard cap as well as the Greyhounds are once again putting up the pressure to recap the point. South looking like...
I think it's mainly soft cap. Yep. It's soft cap. It's getting heavily contested, like... That's really sick, Alexios. Honestly, like, this is the real... Like, you know, they're just fighting for this ground. It's actual infantry fights.
Right. Yeah, no, this is a really good back and forth. And in fact, this is one of my favorite parts of the map to play as an infantry player for this map.
Yeah, for sure.
The back and forth is great. Hunting the OPs down. Just the fluidity is so great with this portion of the map. So, honestly, Chapel, we couldn't have asked for anything better. We are 10 minutes into the match now. DC managing to hold off the push from Greyhounds for the recap. They're looking better as far as map control. And, of course, we have it looks like Vadi going back down to the south. Tried to establish something.
Doing flanking. Yep. One thing I would say is now, you know, the first 10 minutes are gone, so the deployment phase is kind of done. The big thing now is what happens with the first heavy. So it's like, where is the 76? Where is the Tiger? And how is that trade going? If it goes the way of one of the other team, it can really impact, you know, that second phase of the game. So
100%.
I don't know, where is the 76? He's already...
Looks like that's 76?
He's on Hill 5. No. He's just north of Hill 5.
North of Hill 5. Yeah, that's where the 76 is. Tiger playing down to the south for the Greyhounds. And DC looking like they really did a good job establishing control of Grandma's House, pushing 116th back. This creek here, just getting shelled to bits.
Yeah, that's really tough to push. Like, if you don't have control of Grandma, it's like you're just getting completely sandwiched.
This
that
Luke's
is trying its best. It's
empty. Yeah, that Luke's is empty.
It's about to die anyway.
Crew must have gotten out there. Yeah, that's getting shelled now. Over to the south, rockets coming out. That was Calf with a rocket.
It looks way less shaky now, though. It looks way less shaky. Like, it's normal that Axis still has this house there, the one.
Right.
You know, that's one that Axis has to have, in a way. But, you know, they have the whole east part of the town very controlled. They have Grandma. And now 116 has to, like, just grind it out, which is, you know.
Yeah, that's not the fun part.
Heavily on tanks.
Yep. 100%. We'll take a look back further down to the south, near Drowned Fields. As Greyhounds are taking a good amount of resources to figure out where these lone players are coming from. Vadi still in the area. He's going to be getting himself set up, getting his team set up for now. But Chapel's still being contested. I mean, it's not a clear-cut I mean, it's not a clear-cut lead, I would say. Obviously, DC with 3-2 at the moment, they look like they have decent map control, but Greyhounds are keeping up the pressure. This Tiger's going to make things tough for this infantry in the southern part of the town. We'll see if Reason and the other AT players...
Are you sure that's a Tiger? Isn't that a P4?
Oh, that is a P4. You are correct. That's a P4, yes.
Okay.
But
so
yes,
where's the Tiger?
So the Tiger, then, that's an excellent question.
Do we know? We don't know.
I don't think we know where the Tiger is at the moment. Is there a Tiger even up?
Well, it should.
Well, yeah, I don't know if it got destroyed already, unless it's just here. This is the Tiger.
Yeah.
Way in the back over here.
Yeah, so it's trying its best to win that duel with the 76, but, like, he needs to push. Like, I sound like an infantry player, I know. Like, I know it's tough for tanks to push, but, like, here, you...
Yeah, no, absolutely. We definitely want to see these tanks get into the fight. Obviously, you know, you want to play it safe, play it carefully. You know, you have the Tiger in the back line for Greyhounds.
Oh, look at that, though. Yeah, he's already here. Wait.
Sneaky Gorilla and Dabs.
Is that Shokarion?
Sneaky Gorilla and Dabs, yeah. In this tank here. Over in... What is this? Is this Stewie? Yeah. No, this is the 75. The 75 is going to have Phoenix, Shokarion, and Mono.
Wow.
A little bit closer to the midpoint here. But Greyhounds, once again, putting on the pressure on the midpoint.
It's all from the south. If you can maybe quickly open your map.
Yeah, let's take a look at our map here. A couple of garrisons, north and south. That garrison way in the bottom of the map has been taken out. There's another one built in the E7 sector. But yeah, Greyhounds putting up the pressure here.
They're just
all
in southeast, southwest, sorry. Yeah, southwest, like, there's so many people here, but it's crazy how they're capping, though. I think DC are, like, not occupying circle too much.
Right. Yeah, no, we can see that. There's only a couple of SLs in the circle. Not a whole lot, actually, in the chapel. Looks like they are doing a good job defending
it.
And it looks like...
It's really small, so, yeah, you can't really occupy it forever. Oh, there we go, the P4 pushing.
Yeah, no, this is good for the Greyhounds. I think they need to keep up this momentum. They have it right now. They're putting up the pressure, keeping DC on their toes.
For sure. That push here could be really worth it. I think they're kind of...
The problem is the
gambling
infantry.
On the fact the 76 is not checking it.
Yeah, but here comes the 75, though. I think the call has been made that that P4 has pushed up. 75 gonna be hunting for now. The problem is the infantry can't seem to move with the armor right now. DC's infantry are doing a good job of holding Greyhounds back. So I think it's just gonna be tank v tank for the moment. Once again, if you are just joining us, thank you so much for being here. We're watching the grand final for the spring season of 2023. We're watching DC playing as allies here on Utah Beach, taking on the Greyhounds. We're playing as Axis. And DC getting early control of the chapel. Greyhounds now doing their best to take it back. This tank crew is getting pushed, though. Blyker and Paramax.
They don't care.
Taking
Let's
out
go,
the P4. Bar.
Good job.
And that's huge for DC. That 75 is now on the point as well. Not quite on the hard cap, but still securing the point. Yeah, and DC looking
really
very strong right now.
Yeah, I really want that Tiger to push, like, because now you see they're bringing in the second 76.
Right, yep, down
from
the south. Which
is going to make pushing even harder,
you know?
It's like... You know, if they really want to contest this, if you don't push with your tanks here, it's going to be rough. Like, there's so much infantry here.
Yeah, it's a lot. As far as you haven't seen any bombing runs yet to try to take out some of this infantry or garrisons, at least. Tiger looks like it is starting to move up now, though.
He's doing it. I believe, Tiger. Let's go.
These tank fights are so crucial for the momentum of this match.
Yeah, I used this analogy before, but you know, it's really like a MOBA, you know, where infantry are the creeps and the tanks are the heroes. You know, it's really like you cannot do without the infantry, but like if the tanks don't push, usually, you know, you cannot gain ground. Like you,
right?
It's just a stalemate, you know, because on average teams have kind of, you know, at this level here in the finals, it's only 100 very good experienced players. Like, they're all excellent shooters, excellent players.
Mm-hmm.
So you won't just completely overtake the enemy on gunfights alone, you know?
Yeah, no, absolutely not. I mean, this game is about map control. It's about armor dominance. It's about momentum, controlling spawns, obviously. And both of these teams have shown that they're really great at doing that. So if one team can just establish and just maintain that control, then yes, they will be successful. So we'll take a look at Aimless here. So he pushes forward. Recon spawner here.
Nice diving. I appreciate it.
Oh, and unfortunately, it just got nerfed. And it does cost him his life. I was a fan of the snake movement, but Team 17, unfortunately, giving it a nerf, or fortunately, depending on your point of view.
Anti-fun developers.
Yeah. But again, this infantry fighting is gonna get in nice and close quarters here. Cap gonna be shift W-ing. Will he get punished for it? He is gonna get punished for it. We need the trades, and DC getting trades. Hang Pang.
Like I said, 100 excellent players. That's what you have to do. You have to run in and get the info, get the trade-off.
Yep.
You need the space.
Yeah, no, 100%. But look at DC. They're actually making progress pushing west here. This is surprising to me. They've taken control of this creek here. I think we just heard a satchel blow up. And a couple of DC players even getting in the back line. Artie marker still going down.
You know, once you get Grandma's house, you have such a good crossfire on that creek that it's basically for access impossible to push it anymore. So it's basically empty and he just pushes it like no problem, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's like, and you can see they basically vacated everything. Like they're just going where 116 is, which is in the town in the south, right? Like there's almost no DC around Chapel itself because there is no real need.
100%.
And I think that's why we see so much cap progress, is because they actually don't really care, because they know it's only soft cap, right? Like, they know Chapel is completely safe, that it's only 116 pushing from the southwest, and if they want to just revert that cap, they can just put people in the circle, you know?
Yeah, no, 100%. I mean, having that control in north and south, and then just having the circle as a fallback when you really need to. That'll be super effective. Look at the amount of OPs in the south now. Look at the flares going up now. DC know where they have to concentrate. Yep.
Yeah. They're all in E6, basically, yeah.
Yeah, no, for the most part, that's going to be where the action is.
So that is where Vadi runs. Yeah. Let's go, Vadi.
That Tiger has pushed up, though. In fact, we're seeing two tanks here. Let's see which one is the Tiger, or are they both Tigers? Let's see. We're going to have one Tiger in the front, and I believe that is going to be the second in the back, so... Two heavies in the south for the Greyhounds. Looks like we are going to have the 76 up in the north of Chapel, and I'm not seeing the second one.
In here, yeah. Can you open your map again, sorry?
Of course.
There is...
Oh, there's the second one down here, yeah.
DC really needs something like in E7 or something, so they can, you know, do what we talked about on Grandma, but do it for the south there in the town. Like, they need something in WN7.
Yeah.
Otherwise, if you get surrounded, like because now if they lose Grandma, then they're completely surrounded, right? And they have only Shepherd itself, and then your game can get really shaky. Tanks hate it because you have no map control. So, I would say that's the thing to look out for, is are they able to take control of the WN7 and reflank the push of the from the south?
Yeah, no, they had the effort going in the beginning of the match with Havel getting that garrison down. But yeah, no, Greyhounds definitely look like they've taken good control of the south here. And these gunfights actually seem to be going the way of the Greyhounds as they're gaining 100%. More ground here.
Yep, they're really swarming that town and getting control of it for sure.
Yeah, no, 100%. Nades coming down. I think that might have taken down an OP there. Aimless with one kill inside the building.
Oh, Gecko.
He gets traded, though.
Interesting.
He gets taken down now as well. Wow, look at these gunfights going the way of the Greyhounds. Here comes an OP spawn. NVIDIA.
Uh-oh.
Imagine to get a spawn on. Will he get himself any kills, though, is the question.
He's Springfield with a fucking 10,000 scope. He's going
to pull out the pistol. NVIDIA, oh, but
let's
Gecko!
Go. Oh, no. He's running. He's shooting the bike.
I don't know how NVIDIA survived that, but that whole area just got cleared out of any Greyhounds DC. Gaining those couple of meters of ground back. And you know what? Every meter matters here, because when it comes down to the last 10 minutes, if you can get them 50 meters back when it comes down to these last 10 meters, it helps. It definitely helps.
100%. It's all about not getting reset here. Like, 116 have something super powerful going on from that south, right? Like, DC are really...
struggling to contain them.
Right.
But if they all look north all the time, they run into the risk of, like I said, getting reflanked from the south, which DC are not currently trying to do, or like, I don't know, maybe there is a lot of 116 over there, but, you know, in
yeah, there's just no presence at all. Nothing in the south. And a couple of players, but that's about it. So it sounds like they just can't get back there. I mean, there's one garrison here, a couple of players starting to get back there.
They have the same idea. Like, they know what they need to do, but it's of course, it's sometimes hard to do because maybe there's an MG or something looking.
Yep.
But here, that push is really potent. Like we discussed just at the start, it's all about that city. If Axis gets control of that city, it can be really, really tough to get back as allies because that chapel is so bad to hold.
Yeah, no, 100%. And this city, just look at the mix of red and blue here. Paramax going to peek through the fence. He should have seen Haze up. He's going to get taken down by artillery there. Paramax going to go down as well, though. It looks like that tank. The Tigers are starting to move in a little bit here.
Let's go, Tigers. Come on. There's a window here, for sure.
100%. Satchel just goes off in the building. That clears out some DC players. OP getting wiped. Greyhounds are looking strong with the momentum right now. Drayski's going to get a kill. And this is just a great back and forth right here. Soul Raver playing SL, gonna nab himself one kill, gonna have to go prone. Pan is in the area though, crosses the open road.
No problem for Soul. All these Valorant hours are paying off.
Yeah, Valorant is too much of a zoomer game for me. I feel like I'm too old for Valorant. CSGO is more my jam. Soul Raver does get taken down.
Oh.
Not too easy for Soul,
should
unfortunately.
Should have played CSGO instead.
Yeah, should have played CSGO. Oh, man. Well, Greyhounds, though, going to continue the momentum. Already rightfully so, getting laid down here from DC. That's Kendrick on the Artie today. Bombing run getting called in. That's a DC bombing run.
Yeah, they want to clear that south, but that's not going to do enough, I think.
Not enough, as the Greyhounds are contesting and had a little bit of capture progress for a moment here. We'll do a quick pan out to the north, because it looks like there is armor out here. Is that the 76 here? That is going to be the 76. It's going to be Sneaky Gorilla and Dabs. They're hunting for the Tiger.
Yeah, they want to get a shot of that Tiger.
Yeah, those Tigers are... I think they're both
still
down to the south.
Hide and seek, yeah. Yeah,
yeah, those Tigers not going to reveal themselves. Not yet. So Greyhounds still contesting here, still keeping up the pressure. And this is high-level HLL here. These teams know how to play this map.
I mean, such a stalemate at the moment. Like, this town has been kind of back and forth. Like, at some points it looked like it was full DC control, but then at some point it looks like they're gonna be completely overrun, and now it's back to kind of being 50-50. I don't know, it's really...
Well, DC is dedicating two tanks here to the south.
Yeah, I mean...
it's gonna be against the two Tigers. I feel like you almost gonna have to. But yeah, no, Greyhounds... gonna try to, and you know what, I think as the flares come up here, crossing this road just to gain this ground is gonna be a little bit tough. Tigers taking some shells now.
Yeah. It's so rough. Basically, as soon as you cross that line, it's like you're in allies' sight from everywhere, basically. And it's the other way, the same thing the other way around, you know. But like, so that's why they both stay kind of on that side of the road, the tanks. But yeah,
crossing that feels like a death trap if you're not prepared for it. So, DC, a couple of supplies dropping down in the red zone. That garrison looks like is no longer here near the border.
It's in the pens. Yeah. It's in the pens. They're trying to do it.
Yeah, they're attempting, trying to get something set up here for that fourth point. As Soul Raver said in our pregame discussion, you know, winning 3-2 is boring, so they're going to go for the 4-1 if at all possible.
Sure, yeah.
These tanks are going to start to make a play here momentarily.
When you're 2-3, sometimes you have to risk getting one forward so that you can actually try to push, you know, because maybe some attackers get in and then that creates a little window for you, and maybe you can actually defend it, you know what I mean? So, yeah.
Yeah, no.
You usually get one forward because the 2-3 team overcommits because they have to, you know?
Right, yeah, no, 100%. And you really, you have the burden of trying to make the move here when you're down, when you only have 2 points and the other team has 3. But DC are going to continue to be aggressive here as the Greyhounds continue to get that capture progress. We move down to the south here.
Yep. The north is completely, like, scattered, like, some little fights, but here it's all about that town, like,
Greyhounds are really not letting go of that city. It's really nice to see it. So
yeah, no, they're doing a great job here.
Look at that. Oh, Jesus Christ.
Yeah. Oh man, these spawns chaotic. Though. Where is the Greyhounds already? Actually, I'm trying to confirm where that's hitting.
I mean, they must have found that Gary right here, like the DC Gary. You know, it's right.
Yeah.
The
there it is.
Must
yeah.
Have seen it.
Yeah, that Ari's coming down from both teams.
House. Yeah.
But no, Greyhounds, I mean, as far as getting across here, I haven't seen too many DC members successfully stay alive here to the west. Greyhounds, though, have repeatedly made it east. That 76 is now down in the south, by the way.
He wants to peek the tiger, maybe?
Yeah, I think we're going to see some peaks here in a couple minutes.
Flare's once again going up. In between the houses, I think.
With that flare going up, that 76, that position has been given away. Is that an AT? Oh no, there we have the second tank back here. What kind of tank do they have? Just gonna be. Oh, that's another 76 in the back here.
Havelt, what are you doing,
Havelt?
wait a second.
You
can't repair the tank, Havelt.
What are you Havelt. Doing? Damn.
I was like, he's probably pinging the tank.
Probably.
You know, pinging something, but yeah, but he can't ping from there. I don't know. And just having a friendly chat.
Drownfield's being solo capped by Quicknix, by the way.
Quicknix.
Yeah, that should be stopped here momentarily.
North Belgium.
Well, these Tigers still going to maintain control here. Well, I wouldn't say control, just maintaining a presence here in the south. And can you get line of sight here from these tanks? I think you might be able to. If that Tiger scoots forward again, I think that 76 has line of sight.
Definitely does.
But we're about...
I can't see very well, but...
We're about 30 minutes in now into the match. We've seen a great back and forth as DC is still maintaining control of the
midpoint. For now,
midpoint.
Yeah, they push them back again. Like, yeah. I would say again they have full control, but maybe, you know, in the next 5 minutes it will be swarmed by 116 again, so...
Yeah, now things could change here any second. But DC, looking at our map once again, I'm only seeing... I mean, you have one garrison in the F column, one kind of in the E column heading toward Drowned Fields, a couple.
Okay, but that Gary is super important, right?
That oh, this one,
E8
yeah.
Gary? No, no, the E. Well, of oh, course, this one is the central one, but that one in E8, now it allows people to both put some pressure on Drowned Fields and reflank the town from the south, which makes it,
right.
You know, if you're in E6 as 116, you have to fight literally 360 degrees, you know, which is the worst thing you in this game possible, you know, because you always get shot in the back and you have no clue what's going on.
Yeah, no, 100%.
So, yeah, that guy here should, in my opinion, if it like stays up and they can get a few spawn waves off and some OPs, can get really potent. Yeah, Vadi knows, man.
Yeah, no, these
he's always where he needs to be.
No, these players are going to start getting sneaky here. Going to try to find these OPs, going to try to find these players from the Greyhounds. Yeah, this is going to get a little messy here if the Greyhounds don't take care of it. But once again, keeping up the pressure. And is that three tanks? Yeah, that's three tanks. Are these all Tigers? One yep. Tiger. Two Tigers. And three Tigers. This, I think this might be the move the Greyhounds need. Going to start to get aggressive here with the armor now as well. Couple of players here in Drowned Fields. Four players. Putting the pressure there, but one of the Tigers goes down! Or something went down. What was this?
I don't know.
What? Oh, it's just a repair station. Okay, no big deal. No big deal. Three Tigers still in play.
All good. We're good. We're fine.
Oh,
I mean,
man.
It's really... Yeah, that tank push, like, we've been waiting for it. I've been hyping it up for, like, 30 minutes.
Yep.
20 minutes. We have three Tigers now, so... Okay, we have two Tigers now.
Yeah, we are down to two. Yes, that's correct.
Okay, well.
Yeah, that's going to be
I guess
a
we
bit
wait
of...
for the third one again.
Yeah. We are going to take a moment just to briefly look at Drowned Fields as DC are committing more players to it now.
Look at this. Oh, it's actually full of DC.
Yeah, you know
full
what?
Hats.
Yeah, SL's coming down. You have one OP here.
Who's this called? Is it Quick?
That is Quicknix. Yeah, that's Quicknix's OP here. Havel joining the fight as well. Just running through the open field. No big deal. Scarcross just not going to get the
missing.
Kill. Yeah.
No big deal.
But DC putting on that pressure for the 4-1.
Well, it's more than pressure here. It's
They're capping.
You know, well, I mean, the thing is, you know, it's one OP in the circle, right?
Right.
So if 116 reacts properly, they shouldn't have a big issue with dealing with it. Because
right.
It's like... But... The big problem is you need to bring back a lot of players, and that's gonna reset you on your attack on Chapel. And that's why this move is so good. even if you don't cap, because, you know, look, you just get swarmed back.
Yeah.
Even if you don't cap, it's so good because all these players here are not fighting you in chapel, and you're gaining a lot of ground in chapel now.
100%.
That push, yeah.
Let's pan
it's
back
so
over.
It's so annoying as a 2-3 team to have to do that, you know.
No, 100%. I mean, DC looking like they do have more of a presence in the south now. Greyhounds rightfully so responding, but look at the town now. Look at this. It's all blue. That's all DC now. They've lost all of the ground they gained. So even if they don't cap the point here, I mean, that's a huge blow.
Yep. That's basically... That's one of the main reasons why you do it, right? Like, it's not that you really expect to cap. But you see here a single OP from Quicknix.
Right.
Plus that Gary, of course, that we talked about. Meant that they can reflank from the south, so they take control of the city, they put pressure,
right.
And the 16 needs to go back, so it's like a very winning move, you know? That's an error.
That's okay.
He was like, let's go, guys!
A little, yeah, not the best timing for the airhead. I mean, yeah, there it is. It's gone.
You have to go for it sometimes, as a you know. Maybe. You never know.
Yeah, that was an interesting choice. But hey, you know what? It's fine. DC is still with good map control now. That garrison is now locked out. But if DC can clear this out here. Ooh. DC can clear it out, then they should be okay here. Breakpoint getting the kill here. Doctor, will he catch Aimless here? He is going to catch Aimless. Breakpoint needs to come back and get the trade. Otherwise, that Gary's going to go.
Oh. Breakpoint, hello?
There will be no trade. Doctor is going to get the Gary Hunter Doctor.
Oh, he knows. He noticed. He opened his map.
He
oh, no.
does, but a little bit too
okay,
late.
Fine. Well, he should be able to rebuild it now.
But great play here. Trying to get some of this ground back. And Greyhounds are reacting, you know, to give them credit. They're doing their best to get back into position.
Yep, so they basically have to do the reverse of what DC did, right? They have to contest that E8 space again, make sure DC doesn't have a Gary there.
Right.
And then take back again E6, you know, basically redo the situation like we were 20 minutes ago. You know, that's how you're threatening.
Yeah, no, 100%.
Not 20, like 10, yep.
Steven, definitely spotting that garrison there. We'll see if that gets marked for Artie or if people start hunting that. But yeah, no, with 55 minutes left in the match, DC make it a great play to drown Fields and allow them to really just get better control of Chapel here, get control of their midpoint. Armor still looking pretty strong from DC, honestly.
Yep.
I know there was a good back and forth in the beginning of the match for that initial push where both teams are losing tanks, but right now, I mean, the armor for DC is looking really steady.
I mean, like we said at the start, you know, I don't want to be... repeating myself, but you know, 2-3 tanking is really advantageous. Like we saw, these Tigers, they need to push.
The garrison, the sneaky garrison in the back line.
Who built that?
The garrison, the airhead was a distraction.
Yeah, decent tactics.
Oh man, DC with the back cap. I'm not sure who
is
built
it,
that garrison.
That built it? Yeah.
It could be Mike Lowry. There's a couple. It. Yeah, Ninja Pulver's back here. Vadi, Breakpoint, all SLs. Oh man, DC putting
on the
pressure.
That's more annoying because now it's not one sneaky OP, right? You have completely the west side. You can maybe clear some Garys, and you have actually two. How many OPs?
We're seeing four OPs now, plus the
Garys. Yeah, four plus the Gary plus the Recon guy, right? So and they're capping, so that looks really dangerous because they have to come back from east somehow.
Right.
116, but that's not good. You don't wanna be forced to do that. Like it's
And this Puma is empty. Okay, we're seeing a lot of empty tanks here from the Greyhounds. Not sure what's going on with that.
Recycling.
yeah, absolutely. But I mean the DC
75 cap. Yeah, that looks like a cap to me. Because I think they took the Gary. Like they probably have no Gary.
Yeah,
I'm
not seeing anyone spawn here in the area. The spawns are coming from the east.
Oh.
DC are rolling up the tank now. Oof. That's a recon plane.
Defending.
Yeah, Greyhounds are defending now. Here's a Gary mark. Not sure if this is where they're spawning from. That bombing run does not take out the garrison.
Yeah.
Vadi, though, is defending it, or at least trying to defend it here. Tony, the commander. Should be able to get this Gary down.
Yep.
Yeah, Feet Tony gonna take that down. But again, once again, a great push from DC. Yeah. Look at the armor rolling down now to the south.
Now it's not the same. Yeah, it's not that kind of bait so you get space type of push. It's a real push because if they push from the east, like 116, we're all coming back from east, you know, which is ally side. Like, that's not what you want to be doing, you know?
Yeah.
So, like, if they can get completely sandwiched, which looks like
that is
what's
happening
going on right now,
100%.
Then it's really tough to defend it again. So if DC can hold that west presence with their OPs and keep pushing from the east, then that looks like a cap to me.
Yeah, no.
Even if it's not straight away, it looks all the tanks are pushing.
Look at the amount of tanks. 1, 2, 3, 4 in the front line, 1 in the back line, recon tank to the north. DC looking so strong right now. Greyhounds, though, are holding off. They are defending. They are contesting for now. Even if just for a moment.
No.
Yeah, I think the armor dominance here is really showing from DC. I mean, number one, just the SL plays. Getting these spawns up has really opened up the map for them. But having their armor push in like this, I think that might seal the deal here for this point.
I mean, they're really taking every advantage they get from being 3-2, right? And that's what you need to do. Like, it's really, really well played from DC there.
Yeah. No, 100%. That tiger is going to do what it can. Yeah. It's going to try to hold off the infantry, but I think they kind of need it on the hard cap, as it is going to flip here to a 4-1 for DC.
Insta-fifth? Is there anything going insta-fifth, if you can check?
We'll take a look here. Not a whole lot happening. There's some supplies in the area. Nothing. I wouldn't be surprised if Quick Nix and the Recon Tank tries to make a play here, though.
What's he doing in solo, Stuart?
I don't know what he's doing, but we'll check in on him momentarily. That tank is going to get pushed, though. I think, what is this? Is this? Yeah, that 75 is going to go down by that tiger. I think it was just time to die.
Yeah, they just don't care. They just want another 76, probably.
Yep.
But you will see here, like, that's a really complicated phase, right, where you transition into 4-1.
Right.
It's really tough, actually, as the team that capped, to not, like, because sometimes... It was a pretty confident cap, so it's much better than sometimes, you know, if it's a very shaky cap where they're all coming back and you just cap and then you start losing straight away, it can be really dangerous. But here it looks like, I don't know if you can check map just to see if there are 8 out of 8 Garrys. All the Garrys are kind of...
7, they have 7 right now.
Yeah, it's kind of a dismantled Garry simulator right now, you know, because you have only 8 and you want your Garry on drone fields, obviously, you know.
Yeah, LYR is going to dismantle this one, I believe.
Yeah, and usually you don't want to put nothing on chapel because, you know, you might lose it and you don't want to have nothing in the back. So it's kind of like, you kind of spread out, but obviously it's a winning position. Obviously, you're 4-1, but it can be tough to manage.
Yeah, no, 100% here. Well, these players are going to continue on. They're going to move forward. Kaiser and Pegman in the area here. Might catch Zorf here. Zorf. Gonna nab himself 1 kill. We'll pull out for a better view here. This might be a better angle. But Tempe, Mike Lowry, gonna be taking on Zorf and Calf here. Calf playing as AT.
Benjamin, French boy. Let's go.
Yeah, no, I'm not sure who he's from. Oh, these are just hedge-to-hedge fights at this point. Yep. And you can try to get control of this curved street here. This is where you're gonna get probably a little more close quarters. But we need to see these trades come in for these squads here. Got to get these OPs down. Got to get that ground back. As we said, you know, when it comes down to the last 10 minutes, those 20, 30, 40, 50 meters really matter. So these teams are going to be fighting for that now. We're hearing the armor start to roll up as well. That's 76. Going to continue down to the south. Going to eat a rocket, though. That's from Alex. Go back out here for that bird's eye view. More rockets coming out now.
I mean, how do you let that Garry happen? Come on. I mean, it's tough. Like, I know you have to do a lot when you're 2-3, but like...
Right.
It's, you know, it's a red Garry with a big lock. I don't know. What are they doing over there?
I don't know. I don't know what... They're setting
like
something
school
up here.
Project. He has a school project or something. I don't know. He's trying to do something.
Well, we'll see if it pays off for them. Maybe going for
Is
the
he
long
going...
play.
On the Mammoth Radar with Stuart or something. I'm sorry to interrupt the game, but like, what is Quick Nix doing?
We have to see.
What are you doing, bro?
I don't know. Is he...
My brother.
I don't know. Well, he's here.
My countryman.
Yeah, he's out on a nature... out on a drive, I guess. Nice Sunday drive.
Chilling. Been chilling.
Been chilling indeed. Oh, man. Well, Greyhound's going to try to get control of this middle point here, or of the middle part of the map, I should say. try to set themselves up. If they can't take Drowned Fields back, they do want to get themselves set up for Chapel. We are almost at the halfway point in the game, but look at the amount of players and the armor dedicated here to just this one part of the map here. Getting control of this is going to be huge. You have the 76 on the other side of the building and on the other side of the hedge. We'll see if they catch each other's line of sight here. I don't think they will until they get all the way to maybe like on this end.
I mean, morale must be quite low in 116 at the moment. Like, you, I hope, and I'm sure they do, considering how far they are in this tournament. Like, that they have, you know, some strong voices that are like not pessimistic, because you know the situation is very dire. But you know, it's still held it loose. Anything can happen.
Oh, 100%.
You have 47 minutes to play, but I mean, you do have 10% of the map. You know,
compared of course,
to
them
having 90%, which is
it's not ideal. No, absolutely not.
And Quicknix,
what is he doing? Okay, we need to see what's happening.
He's going
here.
To HQ sniping tanks, maybe. He's going to kill some stuff in the HQ.
I guess. That's so trolly. Quicknix. Is he just waiting? Yeah. Quicknix, what are you doing?
Karma, Quicknix.
Oh, man.
Cav is coming.
Cav should take care of this.
He's stealing trucks. What are you doing?
Are you bored? Are you not entertained, Quicknix? Oh no. So toxic.
He's playing pub server.
Toxic Quicknix. Oh man.
How does this guy not kill him? I don't know what's going on.
I don't know. It's fine. But yeah. Flooded house now. We do have armor in play. Yeah, there's the P4 there. They should be aware that the steward's there. The loot is empty right now. Another empty tank here from the Greyhounds. Oh man. Oh, I think. Did that tank just go down? I think it did. Losing that tiger. Yeah, that tiger's gonna be, that's a huge loss for them.
I thought they killed the 76.
No. Possibly. Although that 76 is down as well. So both heavy tanks are down. It's gonna be up to the infantry at least for the next few minutes here. Yeah, we'll check our map here. It's still too heavy. Oh, three heavies down in the south.
Yeah.
Oh man, that
three heavies are already on fourth. It's completely open from HQ to there, basically.
Yeah.
Like, look at the road. It's like, you know.
Yeah, it's not looking good for the Greyhounds. Not at the current time.
Yeah.
So,
if I was a betting man, you know. Yeah. I would bet.
Well, so, we've seen some crazy finishes this seasonal. So who knows? Maybe we might see something crazy here at the end. But really, I mean, the armor dominance once again just really showing from DC. They have really good control of the south.
You know, we've seen crazy finishes, but we've also we've seen them because teams sometimes didn't do what they were supposed to do, in a way.
Right.
And like here, DC is kind of playing perfect game, you know, like based on the layout, like what are their advantages, like what do they need to play off of.
Right.
And it's like they're just doing everything right, like in my opinion. Like there was a really good push from 116, which are also pretty much doing everything right, except missing that Gary is. It's like, it's really bad. Like once that happens and you have six squad leads that spawn in your back, like,
it's not ideal.
Yeah. Yeah. And they take the Gary, your only Gary on your, you know, on your fourth point, you have to spawn from the front line to go defend. It's like, it's
not ideal.
Yeah, that's really backstabbing move. That's really, really, really tough. Yep.
Yeah.
That shouldn't happen. Like,
well, what is happening is the Greyhounds are doing their best to move down toward the south again. We're going to see some more close quarters fighting here. As Nasorin and Jarvanhill going to try to defend this OP. That OP goes down now, not able to defend it. Here comes the other 1v1 now. He should get the peek here. Should see. Oh, he misses the shot, though. You can't miss with the K98.
Oh no, drowning.
Cost him his life. Oh no.
Oh no, oh no.
But
face,
you know what?
Down in the mid.
The OP is down, but Jarvan Hill is the SL. That's the one you need to kill. Oh man, that's tragic. But Artie Marker's coming down from DC. I think that's going to be a bit of an issue here momentarily for the Greyhounds. They need to get out of this position, need to continue moving forward here. Oh man. But yeah, Drowned Fields looking pretty secure for the Greyhounds. Look at this garrison to the north again. It's going to be Vadi once again.
Also, like we said, like very important to have this wide flank control so that you can reflank. It's
right.
It's the same even when you're on the fourth point. It's a bit less true because of how open it is. So it's like you can defend kind of way easier
in here than you could on Chapel, you know, in that town in the south.
Right.
Like, they can have, as you see, some MGs here in the east, and they're just, like, farming everything from the east, like, that on top of buildings and stuff, and you can just...
Yeah, we have Aztec, Dreyski.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, you know, blue, just, oh no.
that's what I mean, you know, you... Yeah. Because you have that line of buildings now, and that are literally yours, like, and you know,
and
it's really...
Here's the other thing too, with the one arty gun rule, I feel like MGs have gotten so much more powerful, because you can't just like throw a couple of shells now at an MG. You really have to choose where you focus your arty, and maybe it's just me, but I feel like this edition, MGs
sure.
have been, they've had such a bigger impact on these games.
Yeah, and I hate them all. Specifically, I hate them all one by one. Yeah, it's awful, awful.
I played my first full comp game, because I played one comp game before. We don't talk about that one. I played my first full comp game about a week and a half ago, Heidi, and it was with my team TL. We played against Broken Arrow in a scrim on Hurricane Forest. And after that game, I have never hated machine gunners. And you, I dislike you and your family and everything you stand for. So,
yeah. I usually scream "no skill trash" when I die 20 times in a row to them, to the same MG. But you can
300
actually
meters
kill
away.
Them.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's like you can, like, if there is a sightline, you can kind of, you know, slow peek them,
right,
and then try to find them and then headshot them from far away, because you know, your rifles are very accurate. But the problem is, with all the flaring and the hit markers,
right,
in a comp game where, you know, you, every time you open our map, you can see we have flares, because we have
right.
always perfect information, so they can just ping and spray. You know, there isn't that component of actually picking them and them needing to see you. They just know
right.
where you are, because you have perfect information at all times. So
yeah, no, the flares are the other thing.
Really,
that's, there's so many things that just make it so tough for the recap here. Between getting the MG set up with the flares, you have your armor. I mean, Greyhounds have their work cut out for them while you're getting one kill on Zorf here. I mean, the gunfights are going, I'd say it's almost 50-50 for specific individual gunfights. But that's not,
yeah.
that's not, you know, the thing that's making the difference, unfortunately.
I mean, macro-wise, there was some, like, they really won on that macro play of having that Gary in the back and notice, like,
right.
that really, you know, and doing everything correctly in deployment. But like, for sure, in terms of player to player, you know, it's pretty average. I would say still DC seems to win more gunfights, like
right.
I wouldn't be surprised then in the stats if
we'll look at Archon,
you know, a lot
after,
of
yeah.
them are KD positive, you know. Still seems to me like it's you know, on average the DC players are winning, but it's the same story about, you know, being 3-2. You can
Yeah.
You know, you can hold an angle, the guy has to push.
Yeah, no, 100%. This Puma here, gonna try to make a difference here, but I mean, with do they still have three heavies down here? I'm seeing one, two heavies, still two heavies for DC, third one rolling in from spawn. Yeah, I don't know about this one. They could just replace them right away. And the fact that their tanks have been alive for so long, I'm sure, DC is not hurting on fuel too much. They're at 650 right now, three heavies in place, though. You're doing just fine, I think.
We haven't seen a lot of 80 guns, actually. Maybe we didn't see them, but from 116, I know on this map, they can be quite powerful, because for tanks, it makes peeking certain angles quite hard. Like, yeah, we see
right.
one here, but I don't know if you've seen a lot of them where, like...
Yeah, other than,
you know,
like, the radar dish one.
yeah, they can serve as pretend tanks, you know,
right.
sometimes. Like, tanks are scared to push that because they get shot from an angle, then your own tank can push, maybe, but...
Yeah, is that... I think
oh,
that's,
wow, there's
that's...
a lot of players here.
There are a lot of players. Why are there so many players? Well, there was a garrison up here earlier.
Well, there was Quicknicks.
Yeah. well, Vadi had a garrison up here earlier, just about 5 minutes ago. So
yep,
I think they
yep,
may
yep.
have just cleared it out, maybe trying to, you know, get back into the fight. But man, that again, a lot of players dedicated to that push there.
I mean, you can see on your screen, Downfields is 900 meters away.
yeah, not exactly in sector, but...
Yeah, it's not really where you want to be, you know?
Yeah, no, 100%.
I mean, you kind of have to, because, like we said, you know, these white flank allow you to get in,
yep.
and if you don't have them, you get reflanked and blah, blah, blah. But, yeah, once you're, like, stuck fighting 900 meters away from your fourth point that you already lost, it's kind of bad.
Yeah.
They're defending with no one again.
Yeah, DC. Well, this look at what DC is doing. They have players scattered all around. And if you're grounded, if you don't know this, you think it's so a much bigger force than it really is. And look at the amount of resources they're dedicating. Flooded house is being contested. I feel like if it were me, I'd almost be in full panic mode because, you know, they don't have that birds in the sky view that we have. You really need to make sure your information's accurate.
Last time you got Gary in your back.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So,
you gotta be paranoid.
I would also be like, guys, hello?
So, but yeah, no, flooded house. I mean, the front door, and you have to have the frontline push, of course. You have Tony, the commander here. Whoops, excuse my counter movement. Tony, the commander, gonna try to get a peek on Sirius here. Should be able to catch one. He's gonna get one.
All right, let's go, Tony. You're gonna carry. Push. You're gonna kill all and retake the point, I believe.
Tony winning a caster award earlier today. Shout out to Pete Tony. And you can follow him on Twitch. And Havold is in play as well, actually, it looks like. Tony's gonna go down. Pang Pang gonna get that kill there.
Unlucky.
Unlucky, yeah. Oh, 100%. But look at this. Greyhounds briefly flashing the contest on Drowned Fields. I mean, they're putting on. They're putting the effort
there's a
there.
Push going.
Yeah.
The push is coming from west. It's not. It's not powerless. I mean, Gecko is here, so he should be able to. Kill
right next
these
to
guys.
The OP. Street's going down here. Scarp Scatter needs to be ready for this. He's under fire, though.
Oh, Gecko gets shot. Doesn't care. Okay,
Gecko going to go down breakpoint. DC are covering this garrison. Here comes the spawn now
the
as well.
Right here,
oh, but he's going to get a satchel. Yeah. He's going to satchel it.
Because he heard it, so he can satchel it right now.
Yep. Oh, the Arty! Big
That's
shell.
Good.
There's an opportunity here.
Yeah, there is to repush this, for sure.
How's the armor looking? 1, 2, 3 heavy still. Oh, 4 heavies. Oh, no. 476s. That armor is the only thing stopping them at this point.
Yeah. I mean, it's the only thing really. It's about you.
Yeah. Yeah. I say the only thing. This is massive. 4 heavies defending Drowned Fields. Satchel goes down.
The ferry's gone, though. They're all dead.
Yeah.
Okay, guys. Let's go. Push.
Smoke's coming down now, though.
Oh, getting stuck in barbed wire.
Yeah, that barbed wire is going to be rough, though. Is that AT gun in play? Is not currently in play. But look at these tanks. They're just in the back line. Staying alive. They're there with the MGs.
They're thinking about battle bits already.
Yeah. They probably have it on their second screen. It's such a low resource game. Battle bits runs great. You can probably just alt-tab back in. Oh, man. But look at the amount of players here on the hard cap now, too.
Oh. That's a good push. That's a good push. Come on, let's go.
They're making cap progress now here.
Yeah,
I think they
could
do it. Here's the huge spawn, though, on the Gary. Oh, not a whole lot happening, though. I don't know if there's a Gary mark on that. The tank is there.
One out the shell.
Oh, no. It's not going to be enough, I think.
Come on, I believe in the recap. I believe.
I believe in the Greyhounds. They can do it. Greyhounds have had some of the most fluid games, I think. I mean, just looking back at the KRT game they played, where they were almost about to cap their fifth point, and then they almost threw and then went and lost mid. They take mid back. I mean, these Greyhounds games, we see a lot of recaps. So I know this team can do it, but against DC, oh, it's going to be tough. Another big Gary spawn. No Arty. We need that 116th Arty.
Yeah, it could have just deleted Circle, and then 116 players could have just gone away from it, you know, because that circle is quite small. You can just delete it with Arty.
Yep.
And then maybe you can, you know, your players just go north and south of it. Like, they had so many people there. I don't know. That's kind of they don't know necessarily that they all spawn in circle, but.
Yeah, well, we're going to do a quick flyer on the map here. Just look. I mean, Greyhounds do have a couple of players in the back line. Again, out of sector for Drowned Fields. But, and if they can start clearing out some of these backline OPs and Garys, it might be helpful. But 33 minutes left. Time is going to start ticking soon.
Honestly, I wish these players in the north were with these guys.
Even just pushing. Like spawn off, like if there's a Gary over here, just spawn off that. You don't need to be that far back. Because it's just resource.
It's like there's a timing for everything, right? Here they had a small window where the DC was kind of low on everything.
Right.
But now, if they can manage to push out again, it's going to be rough again. Yeah,
now we're seeing this tank here start to. Are those shells coming in? What's sort of. Yeah, there's the armor from the Greyhounds there.
What is that? I can't see on your screen.
Let's take a look here. See what this is. This is going to be a P4 engaging the 76. I wonder how their fuel is. I don't know if I want to see a P4 out this late. I just need to...
I mean, it's the auto-spawn, most likely, you know, just trying to clear out some infantry in the circle, you know? It's just like, you know, you can sit there and he's probably kind of pretty much alone. And you can shell the circle and try to not challenge tanks.
Right.
And then you can have impact on the infantry fights, you know? I'm pretty sure that's what they're doing there. Like, it's free anyway, you know, the medium auto-spawns in the middle, so...
Right.
That's usually how people use them because, you know, one guy pushing, well, you know,
oh, look at these
the difference
spots,
is bigger
know.
Between one guy pushing and one guy sitting in a tank like that, you know.
Yeah, no. And look at this.
Okay, LFG for two, go.
This medium tank gonna get more aggressive here. We're seeing a bombing run coming in now as well. That should go down momentarily here. Oh no, DC are trying to shut this down right now. Here comes the bombing run. Yeah, all these players. I think Kaiser even is going to go down now. He got shot anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, that just completely shuts down that entire line.
And DC are going to push into this, obviously, to retake the space.
Yep, 100%. Here comes the armor. Going to fill that in. Oh, but the spawn! No!
Ouch.
Oh, that's...
That's a lot of body parts.
That's tilting. That's tilting for me.
Nice OP, bro.
Yeah.
That's my OP. That's literally my OP.
Oh, man. But look at this. DC actually giving up most of the north, in fact.
They lost a guy in north as well. Yeah, yeah. They're getting surrounded a bit.
Yeah.
There is 30 minutes left, so it's not a ton. But if they get a proper surrounding going on...
D-strike coming in. Where's it going to hit?
Nowhere.
That did not quite hit. Did it even damage the tank? It damaged the 76.
Yeah,
not enough to take it down though. I don't know. The Greyhounds, they might be able to make it happen from the north. You know, maybe. Like you said, 30 minutes left. It's gonna be tough. And I guess it kind of makes sense, right? Because you want to take drone fields back, but then you also need to get yourself set up to take chapel back. It's just a tough play. It's a really tough play. But look at this infantry surrounding this tank here. Zorf may be able to get a satchel on this 76. 75, excuse me. Yep, that satchel does go down here. It's just sneaky in there. Not a big deal. But if that tank backs up, it could get...
That's not nice.
Could get this OP as well. That tank's going to turn around now. Storm should go down here in just a moment. Or he's just going to go down with the ship. Scarpsider just not going to see him. Okay, no problem. No big deal. And I don't know how Zorf is still alive here, but he's getting kills on the infantry. Nasorin.
Wow.
There it goes. Zorf still alive. Oof. Gets a Nasorin as well. Will he get Nvidia? He gets another kill, Zorf. He can't be stopped.
So good.
Hard
while the
play.
Medium went to, you know, explore the Titanic in the depth.
Yeah. Oh, man. What a play from Zorf, though. That really opened that up. Look at the amount of red here. Greyhounds looking a bit better in the north. Taking drowned fields once again. If this play opens it up. I mean, look at the tanks now. You have the heavy in the northeast. You have another heavy.
I mean...
Down in the south.
Kinderik is just going to have a field day here. They're all coming through the same little
river.
Yeah. It's just, if you can just farm there in the north, like, they have perma flares, it's just gonna destroy them. Like, I mean, apparently, they're capping somehow.
Yeah, somehow, they are doing it. I don't know how, but Greyhounds might be able to make it happen.
I mean, DC are not in the circle at all for now, so, are they defending now?
Yeah,
so
they are defending now. Yeah, no, they're getting these spawns back in. They don't want to lose this.
I mean, they were probably just dead, you know?
Yeah. That's also true. Also true. Yeah, the garrison spawn's going to be kind of in the back of the hard cap here. I mean, as Greyhounds, I don't know what you do here. I mean, I want to find their armor.
Keep grinding.
Number one.
Keep grinding.
Yeah.
No choice. All you need tanks.
I just feel like...
As we said, look at the tank wrecks, literally in their HQ. Like they get,
yeah.
Not this one, that's a prop, but the one just in front of Bob there.
Yeah.
You know.
It's yeah, right here.
Just sell them. No, under you.
Yeah, it's yeah, okay. They're here. It's fine. Yeah.
Yeah, it's fine. Don't worry.
Oh yeah, but oh man. Yeah, no, it's gonna be tough for their armor here if they can't even get out of spawn. I don't know how
they
make that happen.
I mean, this is kind of surrounded though, like.
Well, I feel like infantry is doing their job here for the Greyhounds. You know, as you said,
sure.
They were kind of playing the long game. They had people way, and they still have people way out of sector, but it set them up here to get this ground back. And yeah. This particular curve here on the road has been going back and forth for quite some time. It's currently in control of Greyhounds, but look at the MGs. I mean, the MGs are just going to be firing upon that.
Yeah, it takes time because you feel bad because you're so far away. But like we said, you know, you kind of cannot. If you don't have these flanks, you're just gonna walk into shells, you know.
Right.
You need at least kind of two things. Or if you have only one, it's too easy to defend. But indeed, like pushing that north here, like as soon as they go down, they get mowed down by these MGs on the.
Yep.
On the east, so it's really tough. But
oh,
still
look at this garrison.
There's so many people.
Mike
oh,
Lowry. Yeah. With the HQ garrison, I don't know. Greyhounds need to cap this in the next few minutes. They have to have a fighting chance.
They have a good push going though. Like they're getting in.
Yep.
Gecko, let's go. Let's watch that hardcore push by Gecko. Come on, let's go. One,
Gecko did get one.
Two,
gonna get himself two. No, aimless.
Two?
Not
is
so
it?
Aimless as
oh.
He gets one. Reason with the call out there. Oh.
Good trade.
But the satchel, did it go down? No, the satchel didn't go down. That 76 though, taking shells now. There's the ricochet.
Love to see it.
Arty Mark's coming down. Kendrick about to drop some shells here.
Look how many Greyhounds are in the north, though.
Oh, it's so many. So many here. In fact, DC still, once again, set up with their MGs here, set up with the tanks.
They're just farming so hard, I think.
Yeah.
The kill counts must be insane.
Oh, man. Well, these tanks, though, still going to be the anchors for DC. We are at just under 26 minutes left. If you're just joining us, thank you. Just want to take a quick personal moment and say thank you to everyone who's tuning into the stream. We're excited to be here casting the final. Want to say a quick thank you for everyone who is following. Oh, the gifted subs. Holy shit. You all are amazing, and the Hell Let Loose community is amazing. And we're all gathered here to watch this team, or watch these teams, fight for the crown of seasonal champion. And this has been just an absolutely great game so far. From the opener, the Greyhounds trying to get the pressure on the recap. DC going on to take the fourth point. We're seeing a bombery run getting called in now. This is probably going to be a Greyhounds bombery run. Here it comes.
It is. I think they saw the Gary somehow.
That
down?
Garrison is going to go down. 100% yep. That went down. Look at the amount of Greyhounds
okay,
in the red
push.
Now.
Time for push. If
now
you
is
push
the time.
Now, maybe, you know, you just have to dodge... Everything. Just dodge all the MGs, all the RT. Come on, push with tanks.
Just don't
do
die, tanks.
Yeah,
it's easy. But no, Greyhounds trying to get themselves on the hard cap now. That Tiger trying to get themselves into position. The tank marker is down, though.
You can see DC spawning so many support players. They're like, rebuild the guy, rebuild the guy. But it's tough here. That 76 is holding, though.
Yeah, no, that 76.
It's really chaotic. Like, props to 116, honestly, they're really pushing hard. Like, they're not accepting this defeat.
No, 100%. 100% they are not. There's the lone MG here. That's Kieran on the roof there.
Obviously.
Yep. Well, back over to the north once again.
Lasha.
Actually, a good back
One
and forth here.
One of the OGs of Hell Let Loose.
Really? Oh, nice. Well, R4P and Cadaver still up in the north. Blacker Paramax here, trying to make sure this avenue is covered. And again, once again, this house moving, shifting control from DC to 116th, currently in control.
Can look the hard cap? They're capping again.
We'll take a look here.
Pushing in again.
Yeah, oh, the amount of players bunched up from both teams.
Ultra grind at the moment.
No, 100%. Oh, look at the amount of players here.
Yeah, it's like...
Flares coming up.
You can hear the PCs dying. You know, you can hear Let Loose screaming and dying.
the amount of smokes in the air. This isn't even arty smoke. These are just player smokes. Players just trying to move themselves into position, yeah. RIP frames. Oh, was that the Tiger that just went down? I think it was.
Yikes.
Oh, big yikes. DC not giving up control of this specific section of the hard cap. Gonna start to cross the road now as well. driving the hill and yelling to push.
Yes, I agree. Let's go.
Driver Hill with the hype. He's going to go down.
No, it was a nice attempt.
Yeah, no, 100%. No, it's the right call, though. And when the fighting is this close quarters, just this is when you shift W. Just get the OPs down.
Oh, that's an OP,
the
really? Rockets? That's an OP in circle? That's
yep.
an OP in circle from the guy, Belos. They all spawn there.
Greyhounds putting
that's
pressure
like
on the tank now.
Fighting.
Yeah, the real trench warfare here. And they're taking it back, the Greyhounds.
Yep.
Really, and this is the Banzai charge almost, really, if you think about it. That armor, really the last tank on the point now. And you have, well, you have a tank to the north, tank to the south. But on the hard cap here, it's just the lone tank, infantry covering it. But if only the Greyhounds just need their armor back up.
Because it's like 20 meters, right? It's like...
Yeah, it's close.
are the hard ones to push.
Yep. Yeah, that 76 moving. There's the carcass
but
there.
I don't understand 116 RT though. Like, I would just delete the circle permanently and then you can just move all around it, you know? Because they're only in circle DC, you know, in soft cap. Like,
yep.
Otherwise it's full 116 if you just... I mean, they must have that info somehow, like, you know, I know they don't have bird's eye view, but they
right.
have, you know, flares.
Yeah, no,
I mean, there is that presence from Seoul and LYR there in the north, but still, it's like the main contesting point is that circle.
And it's been the circle for the past 20 minutes almost, I feel like, yeah. No, 100%. I feel like the DC Arty has been much more effective. I mean, we're seeing the Arty marks from Kendrick go down here. But, like, the Arty from, like, the Greyhounds, I mean, it's just, you're right, just show the hard cap, you know? That's what's gonna help you the most at this point in time.
Oh, again a big push going. Is that who what exploded?
Let's find out here. I'm not sure what
I
that
think
was.
It's an ice tank, no?
That was tank. No, that was a Puma.
Oh, no. Okay.
The Puma unfortunately going down. But Greyhounds nonetheless still gonna contest here.
Oh, come on, they're so close.
Oh, there's the Arty now. Now that Arty's hitting on the hard cap here.
Yeah, you can just hit that side of the hard cap, keep your guys in the trench on the north
yep.
side of the road.
Yeah, that's going to be effective.
Both arties are hitting,
yeah.
one on each side of the road.
Yeah. Oh, to be a meat grind player right now. Yeah, war is hell, 100%. These tanks just chilling in the back, though. They're safe. They're
yeah.
not under any pressure at all right now.
No, they're chilling. They're probably listening to some podcast or something. Like ordering some Pizza Hut, you know? Doesn't
yeah,
matter. They
no,
can
they're
just
probably just watching the stream, honestly. That's what I'd be doing.
Yeah.
And that's what the 30-minute delay is for. So, oh man, that being said, yeah, no, Kendrick's going to continue shelling this. We'll do a quick pan up to the north because this is just going to continue on for the next, at least for the next minute or so. Over to the north, Greyhounds DC. This road, of course, once again, still being the point of contention. Ninja Pulver in the area. Ooh, let's see who's wearing headphones here. Let's see if they can hear each other. Ninja firing off a couple of shots here.
I killed Zach. So Stan should know.
They should know. Yeah, he's going to hear it. Not going to hit his shots, but Ninja Pulver going to go down, though. Tragic.
Oh, yes.
DC still with control of the road here down to the south. We'll take a look at our map here. Still a garrison up in the north from DC. Probably just to keep you know, some light pressure on.
Yeah, they cannot really make it across, you know, their sector line. I don't know which line it is, but in a way they don't really care. Like they cannot make it to the C line, you know. They're kind of held up
right.
on the D line, and the whole C line is right. full of 116.
Yeah, no, 100%.
But it's shaky. Like this point could go either way at all times. Like of course they still have advantage, but you know,
right.
one good spawn wave, one good arty hit, and then you get that guy down. Someone satchels the tank, maybe.
Right.
Then it can switch, but because it's 116 is definitely super close. We have two Tigers. One is pushing on the left there.
Yeah, we'll take a look here at the armor push here. Now we need this coordination. Artie's hitting the right place now. You have the Tiger starting to move up.
Let's go, Tiger.
And you need to start putting some pressure on these 76s. We have just been sitting here, not uncontested, but they've been chilling here, these frontline ones.
Can the Tiger get a shot off? Like if
they're
if
about
gets,
to get line of sight here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Maybe through that little hole.
Might be able
is
to
kill this. What is that over there? I cannot see properly on this team. Is that a 76?
That is. Let's find out. Yeah, that was a 76. You are correct.
Nice.
That is no longer a 76. There's a carcass there.
Okay, let's go. The second one, maybe.
All right, so let's see if they can make it happen. That's one piece of armor down now. There's still one tank on the hard cap, still two tanks in the back line.
I'm really sad about this red Gary. I'm sorry to bring back to it, but because it's a super close game, like you can see it's such a stalemate, except they got completely wrecked on that Gary in the back and they just lost their fourth point, and then it's like it's a stalemate but on your fourth point, you know, it's different kind of stalemate than a stalemate on Chapel.
I think in the post-match discussion, when these teams are looking and reviewing the VOD, I think that really was what... if Greyhounds lose this, because they still can come back, they're contesting Drowned Fields. If they lose it, I think that would be what did it for them, because they've done a great job contesting both.
You only need one guy, you know? Yep. One or two guys to do that, because it locks the Gary, and then, you know, it's like... It's next to your HQ. It shouldn't happen. But here, like, they're really pushing. Let's go. Like we said, maybe if they get such
maybe?
A tank.
Yeah. Let's take a look. Kale, sneaky FG42. Satchel. Oh, no. But they already...
Oh, no. He ate... Oh, Kale. The bait, Kale. No,
oh, but the OP spawn. Does he get one? He gets one. He gets two.
Oh, let's go, Kale. It's too easy for Kale.
Yeah, there's the call out.
Oh, Winston.
Oh, not quite able to get the second OP. But the callout's almost coming in now.
But they're not actually coming in.
Yeah. just the one. Well, there are more players, though, in the north. Greyhounds getting the capture progress
you
once
can hear,
again.
Yeah. This is panicked. They are not turning anymore.
There was urgency in that callout. 100%. Yeah. That tank going to back up now. They know the infantry is there. They're going to start shelling that.
That's a very good push here. Like, the Gary has been moved up. You know, from DC, has been moved down there, you see on the left.
Yep, DC bomber run coming in, though.
No.
That's going to be a bit of a wrench in the plans.
Effective. Not that effective, to be honest.
No, not that
it's
much.
It's like they already passed it, basically.
Here's the big Gary spawn now.
Chokes. Yeah. Yeah, but they should have... Come on, you have info on that. You can shoot them.
100%. And I'm wondering if these tanks, are they just blocked from movement? Look at the tanks backing up now, though. This is the best chance the Greyhounds have had all game on recapping this.
I think that should be a recap. That should be a recap. Like that push, like we said, it was shaky all the time. It was just one good push and it can reverse.
Yep.
And here it looks like it's going to be a recap. Now, can you open the map just to see what's up on Chapel for DC?
Chapel.
Okay, they're very safe. They're playing it super safe.
No,
like
they're ready for it, yeah.
Yeah, they're not getting surprised by some random spot on
Gary. Yeah. No, 100%. Yeah. But these tanks here have an opportunity. Maybe not so much. I was thinking saying they have an opportunity, but man, having these three tanks in the south still, that's going to be tough.
That's crazy, though, that they recap this.
Oh,
I mean, like 100%. We said, 4-1 is tough to hold, you know, because it's their HQ is right in front of you. You cannot lock it because it's not their point, you know?
Right.
So it's a permanent HQ, and there we go, the recap.
Yeah.
Can they do anything on Chapel now? That's, you know...
That's fantastic
it's gonna be another
work
story.
From the Greyhounds.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have their work
they
cut out for
no
them.
Tanks on Chapel. Uh-oh.
No, there is no armor on Chapel. That tank is going to go down on the point.
Chapel? Can you check Chapel? Like, see if there's any under 16, like, what's going on?
Yeah, we'll take a look at the situation. DC.
Oh, okay.
But look at this. We're back to the beginning of the match.
Yep. That's really good to see.
Yeah, no, 100%. And Greyhounds need to get control back of this town. The artery markers are coming down. They know where they're, you know, they know where they're expected to be. But the question is, can they get there? Still some DC players in the area near Drowned Fields. Infantry spawning back down in the south as well.
Is that
a satchel?
One mistake cost them basically 50 minutes of victory, right?
Yeah, no, 100%. Chakarian gonna go down finally. Oh, and Kadaver gets blown up by the satchel.
It is what it is. It got the repair stations, though.
No, 100%. That tank gonna come and fill that that empty space now in the south. Under 14 minutes left in the game now. DC is still trying to make it happen in Drowned Fields. But Greyhounds have an opportunity here for the comeback of the seasonal.
Yeah, they don't want 116 to be able to teleport back to Chapel, right?
Right.
And so they need to keep pressure on Drowned Fields, especially because, you know, they have positions already, they have OPs, they have everything, because they had the point like 2 minutes ago.
Right.
But now they're capping Chapel.
They are.
From where? Chapel?
another. Well, Drowned Fields is being capped again by DC. We'll take a look at Chapel.
Yeah, I'm high, sorry. No,
that's okay. That's okay. Drowned Fields once again getting capped by DC. Once again, just keeping that pressure up. You have the garrison down in the front. Really just like two OPs, though, to work off of. I think Greyhounds maybe might have hit held Shift W a bit too hard here. But,
I mean, you
they're calling
you need
people
to go
back
to Chapel. Like,
it's a tough spot to be
left,
in.
You know?
Yeah,
very.
Oh, man. Well, that being said, Drowned Fields being defended once again. That Tiger gonna start to push up now, though. Let's see what will it be facing here. That tank is still down to the south here, that 76. They may be in position here to get into a gunfight. I'm not sure if either one is aware of each other. And the college, we should be seeing the callouts here. Henry is in the area, should at least hear the Tiger.
Yeah. He will mark it. Well, he will take it to the squad lead for sure. Or he's trying to get the kill himself, maybe.
Yeah, he might just go for it. Not sure. Is this a three-man tank? Do they have a spotter? They should have a spotter.
Is it damaged?
He's in the bush. Oh, it's slightly damaged, yeah. Oh, he's just taking fire now. The gun is scaring him away. Oh, he's just going to get shelled by the other tank. There's the cover.
Beautiful. Tank camaraderie.
Oh, man. Yeah, no, tanks taking care of each other, watching each other's back.
You know, they have two Tigers.
Yeah, no, they're...
If they can bring these two Tigers up to Chapel, you know, which is quite a way to go, but it's not impossible.
Not impossible is correct. Look at this push back up the creek. We're back to the beginning of the match once again.
Yep.
Can they make it happen? 11 minutes left. We have a seasonal final, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for being here. Heidi, of course, thank you for joining me on this wonderful adventure today.
Thank you for inviting me.
Oh, man. And the push is coming from DC, though. I forget the name of this point here, but I know this is a point, and DC is kind of moving into
Grand
here.
Creek.
Grand Creek, yes, thank you. Or Le Grand Creek.
Le Grand Creek.
Yes.
I even said Grand Creek because I don't know.
I don't know these French words.
It's okay. Can 116 actually push them out of the town? Like, that's going to be
I look
the
at
question
the flares that, here. I mean, that garrison just got taken down, so the question, the answer is maybe. They're putting
they
forth the effort
OPs,
to
though.
Do so. Yeah, a lot of OPs here, at least north of that area. Supplies coming down here from DC. That garrison's still down south. And with just a couple
I'm pretty
minutes
sure
left.
The call was made to just give up Drowned Fields when it looked so shaky, you know.
Yeah.
They were probably like, you know what, just fuck Drowned Fields. Let's just make sure we are like super safe on Chapel. We have all the map control on it, which they clearly do. So,
Rocket from Henry here. That second one could hurt. Tiger's going to turn around, but no matter. yeah, just waiting in the bush. He got killed by the other tank. Spawn back. Getting in the bush.
Right.
Indy going to get out and repair here. Oh, this tank engagement. What? Okay, the double repair. It makes sense. Is he going to get out and repair? Hello? Oh, he's just covering the tank. Okay. You got teammates there.
He's trying to kill the bazooka guy, but the bazooka guy is already dead.
Yeah, no. Oh, man, but yeah, look, here comes Henry once again, though, coming out of the bushes.
He has a plan, man. This guy, you know.
He's a man with a plan, 100%.
Yeah, relentless.
is he going to make it? Tank, you're supposed to defend the tank? Defend, okay, we're good. No panic, it's fine.
He's
going to
come
fine.
Again.
Yeah. Oh, man, that Tiger, though.
What's the situation on Chapel? Is it still as hopeless?
Let's take a look here. Under 10 minutes left to go. Southern part of the town being contested. I'd say DC, not a whole lot to worry about down in the south.
No.
And even the front
anywhere,
door.
To be honest.
Yeah, no, they're looking still pretty comfortable.
Very. So.
Well, taking a look at our map here. Did DC just lose their tank? I think they just lost their tank. Down to the south. Yeah, that tank I think is gone. So that Tiger coming out on top on that gunfight. Still some fighting in Drowned Fields, though. Just a couple of players, though. No big deal. It's fine.
Okay, where are the 116 players? Like, that's what
I'm
wondering.
This is the good question,
yeah.
I mean, Drowned Fields, there's at least, like, one or two squads here. I guess they're just
like
coming from front door.
Scattered. Yeah, they're super scattered. Super spread around. Which, you know, you kind of need. But in a way, like, with 8 minutes remaining, you kind of don't have the luxury maybe to spread around that much. I don't know.
Yeah, no.
100%. I would like to see one of the pushes we had earlier on that town, but maybe they have, like, no spawns available at all.
Yeah, no, 100%. I'm going to do a quick message here in chat. We are going to go to emote-only mode here in just a few minutes here. And just a quick reminder, no spoilers, keep things fun, keep things light, and obviously let people enjoy the game. Now, that being said, with 8 minutes left, Greyhounds are setting themselves up on the front door here, or at least trying to set themselves up here. Streets, Quicknicks, Gas. Gonna try to keep them at bay. Looks like this is just an OP here, though. I'm wondering where the garrisons are. Streets here should have no problem. Streets, RIP. Yeah, not gonna happen for Streets, but... That being said, look at this northern push again. Just as in the beginning of the game, Greyhound's going to set themselves up north of the chapel.
It's pretty good. That's pretty good. If they can clear the garrison north and take Grandmas, then they can. It kind of unlocks the push on the creek, on the river.
Right, right.
But that seems quite unlikely unless they invest really a bunch of people into it, you know?
Yeah, no, 100%. This garrison is getting locked out to the north now. More supplies being dropped in the north. It sounds like they may be trying to get something down, try to maybe pinch them out here if they're realizing that's what's happening. Drownfield's looking pretty safe, I'd say.
Yeah.
Not a whole lot going on.
I mean, they have 5 minutes to start capping, so I'm pretty sure DC can taste the victory, but, like, there is still a chance. You know, we've seen it.
Yep.
We have seen it happen, but... In other circumstances, though, like the front line in these games was like super heavily charged. Here it looks quite uneventful, you know?
Yeah, no.
Maybe that tiger push can do something. He's gonna kind of rush.
Well, you have the two tigers here, right? You have two tigers. I think a third tank moving up now. They're setting themselves up now. That's one tiger. I think this is another tiger. Yeah. Correct? Is this a third tiger? Or is it a P4?
Maybe.
Let's find out. No. Look at the infantry from the north. That is a third tiger.
All right.
Three tiger push. Infantry in the north. 6 minutes left. Greyhounds can do this.
It's exciting, yes. It's not impossible at all. How many tanks does DC have?
Well, let's take a look here at our map. We're seeing one heavy, two heavies.
Two. So they need to make it happen now. Like you have
but
to
no fuel. Yeah. Two heavies,
yeah,
no
go.
Fuel.
Just go, 116. You can't. You have literally 4 minutes. Like you have to go now.
Yeah, no, they have to go now. The infantry is pushing from the north. We're gonna take a look at these gunfights, see how they go. They need the armor support.
Why is it staying back? Push.
Are they starting to move? They're not
but
even
stop
moving.
Stop shelling from so far away, man. Just push.
They're
you
starting.
Have gears.
One is okay, starting to move go. Now. Now they're starting to move. 5 minutes and 30 seconds left in the game. 3 minutes and 30 seconds left to start capping.
It's possible. It's definitely possible. They're
they can happen.
And,
I believe. I love mean, both of these teams, but I believe in the Greyhounds. They lost the mid cap. Everyone said they can't do it. They can't come back. We're about to find out how true that is. There's an opportunity. The odds are not in their favor.
Not at all, but it's doable. It's not 0%.
Right. It's not 0% indeed. We're coming down to the final minutes of the grand final. This tank might cause a problem for one or two of these Greyhounds if they know where to look. AT gun in play as well. That's Reason on the AT gun. MGs in the area as well. We're hearing a bombing run come in. Not sure where that's going to land. We're going to keep an eye out for it. That's coming from the east.
What?
I don't know about that
what
call.
That?
Okay. Not
what?
Quite hitting the mark. I don't know. Okay, it's fine. No big deal. You have infantry
that's
pushing.
That's extremely confusing.
Tiger is now starting to move up, though.
I mean, maybe they have exact
oh, but the satchel.
On the guy, but... Oh, no.
Oh, is he going to get on top? Oh, no. The tiger's going to get
oh, wow.
satcheled.
He does it. Oh, wow. That's big actually
kahuna.
So clutch.
Oh,
that's so clutch.
That might kill this push. They need to kill
him
and need to jump on the tank.
This clutch as hell.
Oh, and they eat the rocket now as well. Seppu. Oh, but the tiger's driving into the infantry. No.
Oh,
the
no.
satchel's on it.
Kill
no,
yes, it
the
is.
Tiger.
Oh, no.
Big Kahuna. That, I think if that kills it,
oh, no.
Big Kahuna
no.
sealing the deal. Oh,
no
one knows.
Sad.
They don't even. Oh, the Greyhounds. I'm so sorry.
That is depressing.
Oh, you know what? Didn't kill that many, actually. Didn't kill that many, but
well,
still losing that
okay.
tiger.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I mean, they only have north, right? There's nothing happening in the south that I can see.
We'll take
oh,
a look
at
that. Airhead coming in now. That's...
Yeah.
Airhead coming in.
Is he bombing on?
Yeah,
that's
bomber going on right
over it. They are pushing hard.
3 minutes and 27 seconds left now. Not a whole lot of presence in the south. I don't know. It's landing right on the chapel?
What?
Right on... Okay. Oh, are they just gonna farm it? Oh, there's the bomber gun.
Yeah, DC bombing gun.
Yeah. RIP Airhead. Yeah.
Ouch. How about farming?
That's devastating. I think that's it for the Greyhounds.
I mean, they can all respawn. There's 1 minute left. If they all push and somehow kill all of DC, they can right. take it.
Yep. Oh, man. There's a chance, but with no armor support, I mean, I'm looking for the tanks now. They lost one Tiger to the Satchel. I don't even see their other tanks now. Unfortunate, but I mean, we have to say, though, just an amazing run from both of these teams. Both teams undefeated before today. There's time. There's certainly time. They have time to start capping. It's just shift W now. This tank here in the middle of the road, gonna be a bit of a problem for him, though. Artie is now shelling.
Oh, yeah. Kinderik doing his best, you know, LMB, F1, F2, R. Impression.
Yeah, no, 8 seconds left. We are about to crown the newest champion of the spring seasonal for the 2023 edition. With just 1 second left, that's going to be a GG. DC securing their victory for the seasonal.
Cope on top. I agree.
The cope on top in Goalie, chat.
You need to listen to go to some proxy chat, I think.
Yeah, I think we should get into some. How dangerous is this? We're about to find out.
Get banned from Twitch challenge, you know, in 10 seconds.
Yeah, yeah, speed running that. Oh, man. Well, that is going to be a GG. Congratulations to DC coming out on top, first place out of 32 teams for this edition of Seasonal. Greyhounds, this is the only loss they've had this entire run. This is the first championship for DC as a team. I know some players may have won championships from, you know, from playing with other teams, but still huge for both these teams. I mean, I got to give Greyhounds credit. They played this so well in trying to make it happen. But DC just having that great map control, armor dominance. You have the sneaky garrison south-west of Drowned Fields.
Yeah,
really is
really
what sealed the deal.
Nail in the coffin. Yeah, like, because it was really stalemate, like, during the whole game. Like, that these fights in the south were really, you know, never really clear who was winning it.
Right.
It was kind of DC favored, like, obviously, but even on top of the 3-2 advantage, I think it was still pretty comfortable for DC. Yep. However, that Gary in the back just destroyed any hope, because then you lose your fourth point, everything is just shattered, and you have to work for like an hour, or I don't know how long it was that they were for one.
It was it was a good amount of time.
good amount of time that you just completely lose, and the whole point.
I think we're doing it. Is this a last minute? Yeah. DC is celebrating their win. What we're going to do here is see if we can very quickly. Can we pull someone into this chat, Heidi? Is that doable?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what? But there's no other. Unless they join the watch party. It's fine. No worries. But really quickly, we'll scroll through the scoreboards. Top squad for DC, Sneaky Guerrilla Tactics and Dabs in their tank. Top squad, actually going to be an imp squad from the Greyhounds. I'm going to have trouble pronouncing these names here, but we'll quickly keep scrolling here. Actually, no, it looks like it is going to be the tank squad. That's Chill Music, PZ, and Indie. So scrolling through the scores there. But yeah, that's going to be the game. I mean, what a match. What a finish to a great seasonal. Any final comments on the game overall, Heidi?
I mean, really well played from DC. Like, I don't know, just, you know, every time I said, oh, this should happen, basically, right. Like, you know, from a perspective where we see, you know, everything. So it's much easier, of course, to say what should happen or not, right? And that's what happened every time, right? So it's really like, of course, they got, like I said at the start, kind of the dream layout, right? Hill 5 into Chapel into Drowned. It's kind of like if I was playing Utah Allies and someone tell me, okay, design the perfect layout for you, I would probably do that, you know? But still, that's a little loose. It is what it is, you know? They still played perfectly according to these advantages, which, you know, is not that easy, because there's 100%. A lot of things you have to keep in mind. 116 played it super well, in my opinion, as well, except, again, that kind of fuck up to let that carry in the back happen, but you know, it happens because you have to overcommit so much to attacking Chapel. But I think very deserved win. I mean, this is, you know, Cope on top, you know? This
yeah. No, they're a great team, 100%. I mean, they've had a great run this entire seasonal. Again, with so many teams, it's hard to be number one. DC have managed to achieve it. Greyhounds taking second place this seasonal. Also want to shout out our third and fourth place teams, FOC and WTH, in no particular order. Heidi, you know, third and fourth, that's not bad. Top four is good. You know?
And I mean, I really wish we would like we could have played DC. Like that's really right. My regret. Like you know, the placing is whatever. Losing in final would have been you know annoying and stuff, but whatever. But like,
right.
Really wish WTH could have faced DC in seasonal. You know, which we didn't.
Right.
We played in HCA, which we won, but it was like I don't know 3 months ago or something. No, right. Less, but. And also it's, you know, it's not seasonal, not that it matters less, but to me, actually, it does. So that's my only regret. But like, obviously, when you look at this, you know, you see that they play pretty much perfectly. They play, you right. know, every player, like we saw them on 80 guns. We see them, you know, being versatile.
Right.
They win the gunfights, you know, they have very good macro. So it's like really happy for all my friends in DC that won.
Yep.
Shout out to you know all my boys.
Oh man, no, it's been
there you go.
No, I have friends on both teams that I'm very happy for both of them. And you can't be mad as Greyhounds for the game that they just played because they did their best.
Really
you know,
well, for sure.
It didn't go in their favor, unfortunately. There can only be one winner, but that's how it turned out. So we are going to wrap up this edition of Seasonal. There are a few things, a few thanks and acknowledgements that I would like to give. First and foremost, to the players, we had 32 teams participate. Rosters, I mean, you had minimum 50 people in each game, but the rosters are even bigger than that. It's literally thousands of players. 4,000-ish players to play in this tournament. We can't do it without the players. We can't do it without our wonderful casters. And I'm thankful that we got to acknowledge some of our casters today with the caster awards. But there's just so much time and effort that people put into this. So shout out to our casters, to the seasonal org who put this on together. Heidi, shout out to you and to Jane for making it happen twice a year for the last several years now.
Yes.
Of course, to the viewers who watch these at home, there's so many people who tune in for these to these types of games, and we're so happy to just be able to put on a show for you. also, big shout out to everyone who has lended servers. With 32 teams playing all over the world, it's so hard to find servers to play on, and we've definitely been saved by a lot of different teams and specific individuals who donate and lend their servers to us. And I want to take a moment, Heidi, if you'll allow me, for a very personal thank you. Number one, for all the support today on the stream, the follows, the gifted subs. I mean, number one, Tigers has gifted 81 subs. That's insane. Thank you to everyone who has donated and gifted subs today. But more importantly, the Hell Let Loose community really helped me out in a time of need this year. Earlier in March, I unfortunately experienced a tornado where I worked. My car was totaled. It was not drivable. I didn't have the insurance to get it repaired. And the Hell Let Loose community came together before the seasonal started to help me get a new car. And that is absolutely insane, something I never expected. And I've not forgotten that. I'm very thankful for that. So I just really want to express my thanks. The Hell Let Loose community can be a bit spicy, a bit toxic sometimes. You know, people have a lot of fun with this game. But I think for the most part, people keep things in good fun.
And it's been so good, honestly, lately. Like, yeah. I don't know. We say that, but like, there's been some issues, whatever. But like,
right.
The relationship between teams is very good. Like, I think we have a really healthy scene. Like, of course, people joke around, whatever. It doesn't matter. Like, compared, I think, to most other games, we have such a nice scene. And that's honestly the reason why we keep doing this. Probably,
right.
Because, you know, we all hate the game to some extent. But like,
right.
Community is really nice and overall. So
I've made some of the closest friends that I have because of HLL. So it's
sure.
No, we don't want to let a few bad eggs, you know, ruin. I think what we have.
My girlfriend Toy Helicus. So
of course, yeah, 100%. So Heidi, we are gonna wrap it up. Next seasonal.
Just one thing.
Oh yes.
Yeah, exactly. Next seasonal, the signups are going to be open very soon, winter seasonal, which is going to start right after HCA in October.
Yep.
All the information, blah, blah, blah. Just leave us some time, you know, to chill down after this edition.
Of course.
Everything will be out. And yes, there will be one. You can stop DMing me to ask. There will be a winter seasonal. there you go. And thank you to everyone for this edition. It was great. And there we go.
No, 100%. Heidi, thank you again for joining me, being my co-caster thank you. On this wonderful game. Shout out to DC. Congratulations on winning seasonal. Greyhounds, of course, Greyhounds, a solid game. Second place, nothing to write home about. Next seasonal, again, coming in October. Personal note, we're doing a charity stream next Sunday. It's going to be Remagen. Sign up for that if you want to play, or just come in and watch right here on twitch.tv/MrNitro. Stay tuned for that. Otherwise, have a great week. We'll see you next seasonal. We love you. And
love you all. Bye-bye.
Goodbye. I'm gonna go to the bathroom.